first of the NorCal trip with some heavy hitters. We got Paul Bailey. Can you hear yourself?
Oh, yeah.
You can say hi if you want.
Oh, yeah. Hey, guys. How you doing?
Aaron, hey, Britt.
What up? What up?
And then this guy that's trying to go places.
What up?
What's your last name, Johnny?
Zeolla.
Zeolla. There you go. Another piece of the puzzle. I got to come up here for pretty much them, and then I'm going to hit Caesar, Jeremy from Black Dog, and John from GSJ. So this is a good one because I feel like each of these guys did something, have done something really cool in the fishing industry, with Paul with the big baits. Johnny, pretty much, I think you changed the game kind of in filming some of these videos.
I agree.
A little bit. Tweaked it a little bit, but I don't know about changed it.
Well, no, because truth be told, a lot of the videos I've seen look like dog shit. You know, our people don't take the time to really, you know.
Put the time in and make it look pretty.
What's yes.
Right? Okay, what is it? I just have it hanging here.
It's either on or off.
We have a peanut gallery over here, my wife.
You look weird.
My wife.
My wife.
But no, I really do think that, you know, when I saw the iRod video, the first one I saw was like, fuck. And I saw the AFCO stuff, and I checked out your channel. But I feel like all you guys are kind of doing something crazy. And same thing with Aaron. I mean, fuck, man. Not many people got Pacifico as a sponsor. That's a big fucking deal.
Hey, he's trying to live that good life, man. Yeah, right. Get in where you fit in.
Let's start with Paul. Everyone kind of knows what you did or what you do, you know, like the big bait thing. What kind of go over how you met Matt and how that all came real quickly. You know, you guys hooked up and.
Yeah, me and Matt, it was kind of weird. We were fishing tournaments against each other. Him and my brother were fishing against each other, I should say. And then, you know, I kind of fell into the mix. I was racing BMX for a long time. I ended up breaking two bones in my leg. I had a big surgery. And so I was out for about 9 months. And at that point, my brother said, hey, dude, come bass fishing with me. You know, we catch them on these giant baits.
Yeah.
And I said, what? And he says, yeah, look at these things, man. We throw these things out and you control them behind the boat and they blow up on it. 12 pounders. And I said, what? And he takes me out. And I mean, the first day we went out, it was awesome. I think I stuck one, maybe 8 pounds, you know, and he looks at me and he says, all right, you broke your bubble, you know? And then I was hooked from that day on. And then, Matt ended up being at the lake all the time, worked at the local tackle store. Me and Matt ended up becoming good friends, and kind of the rest is history. The big bait posse came about and, you know, everybody kind of went their separate ways. You know, Kerr went on tour, you know, my brother went out to Havasu to mash and absolutely own that place.
And yeah.
And then I came up to Clear Lake to just have fun and throw a swim bait. And that's kind of what my life consists of. It kind of turned into my life when it was just kind of a hobby.
Do you feel like you, made yourself a little more private? You know what I'm saying? Like where you're not like a limelight guy. Cause everyone knows who you are, but I feel like you're barely starting to dip into the YouTube kind of hard now, your own channel.
Right.
So now you're kind of changing up a little.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I just look at fishing as something I really enjoy. And I actually really, really enjoy teaching people about fishing. But the direction after the posse that the whole swim bait game went just kind of rubbed me the wrong way. You know, I'd get on these forums and I'd read through these kids asking questions, and I'd see 50 comments of kids being total dickheads. Sorry if I can't say that, but
no, you can say whatever the fuck you want to say.
Okay. God, dude, I would get on
dickhead.
There.
Yeah.
All right. We broke the ice. But yeah, no, I would get on there and I'd read these, you know, kids making fun of other kids when in fact nobody there has any clue what they're talking about. And that's kind of the direction I saw it going. And I wanted absolutely no part of, you know, some 15-year-old tearing down an 11-year-old because he asked, you know, hey, what do I throw my Hinkle on? You know, you don't know, you can't read, you can't search.
How do you not know that, dude?
Yeah, how do you not know that? You know, you haven't read all the posts on this page, and there's 7,000 posts in 2 days. And so that just kind of rubbed me the wrong way. And I just like to fish, you know. I like to fish, and I like to show people how fun it is. And Johnny has absolutely opened my eyes to the cinematic side of this game, which is very untapped right now. And that's kind of what I'm into right now. I'm into just getting really cool shots. It doesn't have to be a 19 pounder. I just like to fish. I like to throw a swim bait, and that's kind of why I moved up here. So I kind of stayed away from the forums and the swim bait game and that whole scene kind of on purpose. I love it. I absolutely love it. I love everybody's love for it. But the way they were treating each other kind of drove me away from being in the limelight, I guess you could say.
No, it makes sense 100%. I mean, you, yeah, I think the way you went about it is probably like what I would have done if it was something. Music was my thing.
Okay.
So I kind of like had a kid and just went, I'm fucking done. You know, like,
right. Right. Yeah.
You know, like, it's a hardcore band, so, you know, like pretty much after BMX, like you, it was music,
right.
Played bass, guitar, drums, everything.
Oh, very cool.
But I mean, it's cool, but it's also cool to hear you kind of speak back up, because a lot of dudes, you know, came along and been doing the swim bait thing when you've been doing it since the get-go, kind of, you know what I'm saying?
Like, right.
You remember all the times of, getting the first baits that came out, you know?
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. When we got the first set of HUDs that were ever poured.
That's crazy.
You know, we got the first batch. I think Newman got a couple. Me and my brother got a couple. Butch got some. I think Bill Seamantel got a few.
Yeah.
And we all kind of went out our separate ways on different lakes, and it was absolute chaos. But yeah, from the beginning, we've been doing it since, I can't say the beginning. There's a core group of saltwater guys that were really throwing the
big, they don't count though.
The big worm kings and stuff, and really opened all of our eyes to, holy crud, this could be a thing in bass fishing, and that's what it turned into. It turned into a really big thing.
And it's cool to hear that you kind of cut your teeth down south.
Right.
And then you bring it up here. Was that kind of a different transition when you, how old were you when you came up here?
So when I moved up here, I think I moved up here when I was 28. So I had been fishing since, you know, 19, 18 at Casitas and Castaic and Piru and all those lakes. And they were consistently getting stocked with trout. So it was absolutely ridiculous. It was an untapped game. And that's literally what it was. It was a game. You'd go there and it was, yeehaw. that's literally what it was. But moving up here from there definitely translated. This lake is a swim bait lake, and you know, you can go to a trout lake and throw a swim bait and you can get lucky. But here with the bait fish we have and everything, it's a totally different game, but it translated because it makes you focus on just throw the swim bait.
Yeah.
And that's what the game is. Just throw it and learn it.
Did you, when you first came up here, cause I know it's kind of like with fishing could be a locals only thing. The people come up and go, what the fuck are you doing here, bro? This is like, you know, don't come in. But the same time, you kind of kept quiet and you weren't doing that shit. Well, maybe you were. I mean, that's right. A hard one. You put out a fucking video, so people probably thought you're blowing up their shit up here.
Right. So that was kind of a weird deal. You know, I was really kept my distance from everybody up here when I first moved here. It just so happened when I moved here, I was working as an electrician, and my boss had moved here and transferred his business here over to Ukiah. So when I moved here, we ended up having, I had a job. And he was my team tournament partner that I had won a lot of money with down in SoCal throwing swim baits. And so we already clicked, we already meshed. And when we started fishing tournaments here, it was top three, top three, top three. Because we knew how to throw a swim bait. We knew where to throw it. We knew what to target. And I just kept my distance. And everybody slowly just started coming up to me at the tournaments. Hey, I'm so-and-so. Hey, I'm so-and-so, you know. And I went about it that way instead of kind of, you know, hey, third place on Instagram.
Hey, pulling your dick out and trying to
I got a third place today, you know, or I got a second place today, you know. And kind of, that's kind of more my style, you know. I like showing people, you know, hey, look at me, you know. I mean, I can't remember anybody filming themselves fishing before we did it. Honestly, I don't remember, you know, so I'm pretty sure we had a lot to do with the whole GoPro, you know, on the boat. And it's just fun to show people what I do. And that's pretty much why I do it.
And I feel like you made your point when you filmed that video. How many fucking double digits did you guys catch?
It was a little ridiculous. It was to the point where we were catching so many 7 to 11 pound fish that we just stopped weighing them. It didn't even matter at that point. You know, we'd have a weigh-in shot for every fish that we caught, and we ended up using none of them because it didn't matter. It was just like, this is pure awesomeness. And that's all we wanted out of it was put it in before you go fishing and make you really want to go fishing.
Did you get shit for that? Did you guys get some shit like from people going, you fucked our lake up?
No, because we were the only ones doing it.
At the time.
Yeah. There was that small core group of guys that were winning the tournaments, and there was maybe 8 teams. And of the 8 teams, we had 5 of them in our crew. So it was really, hey, are we going to blow this up? And then once we saw the direction the trout plants were going after 2 years, then we said, guys, we've got 2.5 years of footage we've already collected. Like, we got to do this now because it's never going to be like this again. And then it doesn't matter if everybody comes up now.
Yeah.
And so that's what we did. We just rocked it, threw it out there and said, you know what? Forget everybody. You know, it ain't going to be like that anymore.
No.
And that's what happened.
And that's what kind of Matt said the same thing after that. It kind of turned off.
It just, the trout plants are everything, and they have to be consistent. You can't get one every 4 months, you know, two.
And you're not, you don't think you'll see the size anymore down there?
You will. You'll see the size.
If they keep planting them.
They got to keep
planting. But not the way it's going right now.
Not the way it's going right now. I heard this year's been a lot better down there. I'm not down there very much to be able to be able to keep up with the game. But from what I've seen on the DFG plants, and the state of California is owed a lot of trout right now. So I would imagine Casitas has been getting a bunch, Castaic, Piru, all these places have been getting multiple stockings this year. And since the road's so much, I think it's only going to go up. They're going to have a good time down there the next few years, I think.
Yeah, it looks like it. The guys I've had on kind of want to push for something too. I mean, we'll see how it goes, but let's move to Aaron over here.
Let's do it. He's a fun
He's legit.
Oh, man.
This guy over
fun
here.
One, whatever
is, that, is that a name from fighting?
No, God, I wish. No, I was actually, back when I was like 2011, we were doing a fantasy football deal, and a buddy said my last name, Britt, and he fucked around, said something about legit, and he's like, legit, Britt, and I was like, and normally I give people shit for nicknames, I think they're fucking stupid, you know, like when people call themselves something, I'm like, it's so stupid, but I was like, oh, no, she sounds pretty cool, and then, and I even got more, so I remember my rookie year on tour, I went out to, when I was on tour, you know, a lot of the guys were like, you know, one guy in particular pulled me aside after a derby and was like, you know what, Britt, I'm not going to lie to you. You come out here with your flat bill and your tattoos and you call yourself legit. I thought you were going to be some fucking punk. He's like, you're actually pretty cool. You know? So, I mean, it is what it is. I mean, it's not, I mean, I'm not like I'm legit. Like, it's just kind of stuck with me. It's not like I'm a gloating term or anything. It just kind of, you know, rolls off the tongue and it just, you know, it's my guide business, legit Britt guide service. And
yeah,
just kind of rolled with it, man.
You've been fishing up here. You lived up here your whole life.
Yeah, I live in Yuba City, which is about an hour and a half from here. Yeah.
And when did the? I know I don't ask the fuck. You guys listen to the podcast. How did you start fishing? It's like, okay, we're past that. I know how you fucking started. Yeah. You know, but when did you decide to go to the tour thing? Was that after fighting?
Well, fighting. We'll touch base on that in a little bit. But yeah, fishing's always. I mean, fishing. I mean, like Paul touched on it. It's a life to me. You know, I eat, breathe shit. Bass fishing, it's just something that I think there's a difference between liking fishing and loving to fish, you know, and there's a substantial difference between the two. And I just been fishing my whole life. I grew up river fishing for striper, salmon, sturgeon, and in fact came out here to Clear Lake when I was 16 years old for the first time, fished with a guide, and that was back when it was fucking booming, you know, it was April, we were catching them on Cinco's.
Who was the guide you went out with?
I think Dave Majestic, if I remember correctly. You know who that is?
I remember Dave Majestic. He hasn't been around in a while.
You can kick that if you want, like how it's comfortable.
And I haven't heard his name in a while. But I was bass fishing, you know, prior to that, but that was the time where I remember just being like, fuck, this is what I want to do so bad. And
yeah.
Fished here, started doing that. And then, you know, I was fortunate enough to win a FLW series tournament up here in 14, which really, really kind of kickstarted
my career.
Kicked
my butt.
Well, you know, it's funny.
Kicked it.
You wanted to tell that story because I had Tom White on and he kind of told his, and I thought it was really cool the way he explained it. Talk about yours because, I mean, that's like a game changer to me.
Sure, 100%. Know? Yeah, so I think I was actually up here. I think I stayed with Paul that tournament. No, I didn't. I stayed with Chris down. But we Paul and I have always, you know, Paul has taught me a lot up at this lake. You know, when you fish, you self-learn a lot. But, you know, no one does this by themselves for the most part. There's always a little small networking group, and you keep your circle tight. And Paul has always been, you know, extremely helpful, and I've learned a ton through him up here. And I'm sure he's learned some things from me. You know, we fish similar, but there's certain things we do differently. But we had a very pretty similar practice, Paul and I. Know we were catching 18, 20 pounds a day on a square bill. I had one spot that the last day of practice, I caught. I probably shouldn't have caught this many, but, you know, I was young and dumb. I think I caught like 5 6s in a row on a deep crank. I just kept fucking throwing in there. I'm like, look, that's another one. So I caught, you know, I had 30 pounds in 5 casts, and I left and rolled there the first thing. This is back when I had a 94. I was fishing, I have a 94 Ranger, 150 Merc, and probably putting me about 52 miles an hour. So I was never the first one anywhere. Got the spot, was open. Did not catch a fish on it. Ended up leaving and just actually fished all the stuff I was catching. Never caught one. Pulled up a deep crank on Glenhaven, which is one of the most, you know, popular spots on this lake. And fucking jacked them. I had 29 pounds on the first day.
And were you fishing solo with that one?
No, that's with a co-angler. I was fishing with, actually my co-angler was leading the tournament after that first day too. He had 24, then blanked the second day, didn't even catch a check.
Oh, fuck.
But we ended up going back to where I started, I ended up catching 8 at the end of the day and gave him a crankbait. He caught a 7 on it.
And then that was cool. A cool move on you. You know,
you know what? I had 20. I had 29. If I had 15 in the box, I'd have told him to fuck off. You know, but I had 29. I was feeling pretty good. I'm like, dude, here, fuck. You can use my rod if you want. I mean, that's kind of where I was at. But
it's amazing how nice we become when we've got a big bag in the life world.
Oh, yeah. Another thing too is, for me particularly, I tell people I'm in my most obnoxious form when I'm sober. And fishing, like there's a fine line between passion and excitement. And if people have been on the boat with me, I mean, I go from the high to lows, and the overall experience throughout a day of fishing, your emotions, fuck, man, I can't.
Oh yeah.
I can't. I've gone from wanting to punch a baby to adopt one in 2 seconds. I mean, literally. And it just, you know.
Can you make a shirt that says that? Because I will buy it.
Yeah, I'll buy that.
I mean, hey, don't worry. So I have a soundboard right here.
Oh, nice.
And I'm taking people's little, the ones that I like, and I put it on.
Save them.
So I have one of an old ship captain, Alan Watson. He's like 80. Let's see if we can hear it. And then I have some saltwater tournament anglers. This one, let's see. So you're gonna be right there.
Mine's too small to measure, so thank God I'm on that boat. I'm Jewish, we didn't get blessed on that part. Anyway, so day two, I was leading the tournament. Day two, I went out and fished pretty much the same areas. I think I weighed only 18, but I had, I think, 26, 27 hooked. I lost two real big ones. Fell to second place, and then the second or third day, I went out with Todd Klein, who ended up winning the Derby on the back of the boat. I was down, I think, 4 ounces, I think, and went out, and I think I had 19 pounds at about 255, and I was on Glen Haven, and I threw a crank out there, and to this day, I'm not sure how it happened. I remember winding it, and it doesn't get to the bottom, and I feel a fish bite it. And usually when a fish bites the crankbait, if you fucking got it. And I actually literally felt this fish bite it and missed it. And I remember just going, fuck. And I remember throwing back in there, and I had my head up looking at the sky, winding, and it fucking ate it again. It was an 8-pounder, and I culled it. I remember Todd netting my fish. I'll never forget this. Netting the fish. I'm on the back of the boat. He nets it, and he just drops the net on the back of the boat with the fish still in. I'm hugging him, jumping. The fish is flopped. Like, I'm not even paying attention to the fish, and freaking out, screaming, and ended up getting the box. And, that was an emotional moment for me. My parents were there to watch that. And, like I said earlier, passion. I think I've cried on stage 3 or 4 times just because the amount of work we put in to do this, and the drive I have, and, you know, wanting to be the best. I set my expectations very, very high in this game. When I don't meet them, it bothers me, you know. And like when I go golfing, I play golf. I don't get as mad as I used to, but I'm not supposed to be good at golf.
Yeah,
I'm supposed to be good at fishing. I put all my time and energy. So when I don't do well, it's like, fuck. So winning that Derby was big. I ended up, you know, spending all the money I won and bought half of a new Ranger, you know, in 14. And, fished a couple more years, and went on tour in 17, and had the rookie year, top 10 Forestwood Cup, cashed top 10 Derbies, finished 28th in points, you know, and just had an amazing year and fished real freely. And it's been a fun ride. And like I said, I picked up Pacifico as a title sponsor this year, which is
awesome.
Which it's fucking huge. You know, to be a person like myself, you know, it's funny. I actually had a meeting with the head guy, and we met up, and he goes, dude, you're what we're looking for. You know, you're tatted, you're young, our motto is live life anchors up. You know, it's what we're looking for. And and I take pride in all these sponsors. Every one of them I have. I feel like
at the same time you set yourself a little different than everyone else.
And I'll tell you what, and I tell people all the time that I'm not everyone's cup of tea, but I'm most. And I'm okay if you don't pick up I put down. In fact, it doesn't fucking bother me a bit. You know what I mean? I'm not for everybody. I'm honest. I keep it 100, and some people pick that up, and some people don't. And again, I'm good with both. And I'll never change who I am to make someone else, you know, have a different opinion of me.
That's something I should live by. I'm trying to do that right now to get some sponsors. You know, what I'm
yeah.
I say fucking shit too much.
Just do you, boo boo.
Hey, there's plenty of sponsors for everybody. If you just know who to contact,
yeah,
be yourself, yeah, you know. And just like Aaron said, yeah, dude, don't change for nobody. Yeah. You're
But I think that's really cool. You kind of. It sounds so fucking dumb. The bad boy image. You know, but it is. You're tatted up. You got neck tats. It's like some people don't want to touch it, especially in the fishing industry.
Oh, yes.
They see that, they go, oh, this guy's a fucking, dude, you know.
And I can't tell you that many times it's happened, but my mom always said it's not how you look, it's how you act. You know what I mean? And if people, you know, my tattoos, you know, I got stay true. I got fishes. I got my mom, chase your dreams, never give up. Like all these peace and love. Like they're not like thug life, fuck you, eat a dick. Like they're, you know.
I would have got eat a dick for sure.
Put it right above my butt, my little tramp stamp. Dick goes here. It's been a fun ride though, man. I've got the people I've met I mean, I'm sponsored by, I mean, I got the coolest, I mean, these iRods. I mean, I got,
we love iRod here. All of us love iRod. Right?
And the cool story about that too, is I remember I was at a, I think I was fishing a coaling during the Delta. And at the time I was with Pal and, Keith was, Keith's whatever. I haven't talked to Keith forever, but, I was getting a little percentage off him and I didn't expect much. And I think Matt actually approached me when I was in the weigh-in line and said, hey, blah, blah, introduce himself. I hear about you. Would love to have on the staff. And from that day forward, it's been, and I had a, this is probably 4 years ago, I had an offer with Daiwa. I said I wanted to use their their reels, and the guy said, we'll give you a deal with rods and reels, but I said, fuck, man, I don't want to go back on Matt, I'm loyal to,
that's being true, man,
it's what it is, yeah. Matt's been good to me, and she's taking care of me, and it's like, I would expect someone to do that to me, if someone would just, put me in the fucking dust for something like that, I'd be using the same smaller reels for 3 fucking years. I just clean them every year. So if any reel sponsors out there want to, give me some reels, please. I need some.
Well, yeah, I mean, I just caught a nice plunker fish on your brand new rod.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, I got a couple rods. I use the Kamado series a lot.
Those are nice rods.
Those are super nice.
T-hooked me up with all those.
Those are awesome.
Yeah, I love them, man. And
Paul's got the new one, the cork handle. Those things, that one's out, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Is it the mag, yours?
It is.
I've got it. The cork handles are on the 804s. The cork handles for the 865 mag are on the way right now. Okay. But yeah, the new cork handles for the 804s are freaking awesome. I was fishing it a little bit today with the HUD and, it's cool, man. I was never a big cork handle fan. I don't care about having a long handle. The HUD, the Hinkle, the 250, everything, it throws itself. You don't really got to put too much effort in. It takes a little bit of loading the rod up and off it goes. And so I never looked that far into the rod. I'm more worried about the action of the rod than I am how long the handle is. But
when you're a short guy like me, that handle helps a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I get that, I fucking... need to get that.
It's like a catapult.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Exactly. Exactly. Now, now Aaron's got his new rods coming out, And so,
is there a name for the new rods?
Well, the legit Britt finesse or legit's finesse swimmer, the spinning rod, but we got one.
Oh,
we had
I can't wait.
That's out. It's been out for a while.
Drop shot.
Well, yeah, you do whatever you want with it.
I'm a slut for the drop shot.
Dude, a lot of everybody guys love that.
We got a bait casting version coming out. Just a few more little tweaks to it, and that should be coming out hopefully in the next couple months. But, it's just been a fun ride. I mean, to people I've met, the people I've got to fish with, the sponsors I've gained and maintained, and it's... I'm living my fucking dream, dude. I mean, it's as simple as that.
You do guide service.
And I guide up here.
Is it full time then, fishing and guiding?
It's full time, yes. When I come back, I do full time guiding. It's just fishing, man. It's, I play a lot too. I'm 34 years old. I just recently started seeing a girl, so it's going to be probably a little different now. But prior to that, I was, she's the best. Hi, Daniela. it's just been a fun ride, man. I don't know. I grew up watching these guys. I grew up, idolizing these dudes, wanting to be these guys, wanting to fish them. Now I'm fucking fishing against them.
How about this? You ever get big dick? This is a term on the podcast. Oh, yeah. You ever get big dick by someone you idolize and you're like, fuck yeah. You don't got to say his name.
I don't get big dick by anybody. No one big dick. I came on that scene.
Hey, I am the big dick.
No, it's not that I'm a big dick. It's not that I'm acting like I'm gloating, but people know, don't fuck with me on the water. I don't bite my tongue.
How about there's someone that you respect and you're like, yo, I can't wait to meet this person. And you go up to him and he's kind of like,
Cool. That's great. What's cool about it, once you get to that level, we all share the same passion. We're all there for the same reason. So if there's one person, one person who, and this is no knock on him, but who I thought might have been a little dickish is David Dudley. I've met him. It's no knock on him. David's a great guy. There's been a few times where I thought he kind of cold shouldered me a little bit, no knock on him. He asked me a question. I answered it honestly. It is what it is.
And did you tell him, hey, dude, I feel like you're fucking
No. But I will, David, where are you at?
No. But I mean, that's happened to me. I've had experience. I've talked about the podcast, with local dudes where they're fucking assholes.
Yeah.
And I hit them up. I go, dude, what did I do to you? And they're like, I'm sorry. And it was cool.
Yeah.
Why are you a fucking asshole? Sure it happens all the time.
Fishing is kind of like that. Fishing, because everybody just kind of keeps to themselves.
Yeah. Who's this guy over here?
Yeah. I'm pretty vocal. I show my cards pretty spare early. Change? I show my cards pretty early. I do that because I don't want months down the road someone having a question. I'm gonna let you know who I am, why I'm here, what I'm about, real fucking quick. That way, there's no questions.
We're gonna keep doing the circle. Mm-hmm. We're going to come back and hit certain topics. Oh, cool. So okay. Let's do the next guy. This guy's kind of, he's kind of cool, I guess.
He's got nice hair.
Yeah. He's a camera nerd.
They're
camera
flowing. Nerd. Fucking L'Oreal. He's got L'Oreal 2-in-1. He's got good shine, good bounce.
I put my leave-in conditioner, everything.
He got a Brazilian blowout over there.
I do.
Yummy.
Johnny, your last name, I'm going to fuck it up if I say it.
Zeolla. Everybody says Zeolla. I don't know why.
Zeolla, like Eddie Fiola.
Yeah.
Yep.
Italian. It sounds like a brand of sparkling water.
Right?
Zeolla.
It does.
Oh, man, this is going to be a real fucking good one. Yeah. Let's talk about you. The first thing I saw you do was the iRod video, and I was very impressed. I think you're kind of doing something different, like all these everyone else we've talked to, with film and video. I feel like you you changed it up a lot, and the editing you were doing, you know, everything looks great. When did you start getting into that?
I actually got into filming. It was probably, I did a long hike on the JMT and literally just started filming with my phone. My cousin was like, oh yeah, dude, check out the cameras on these iPhones. And I was like, okay, like, I don't really know. But we had nothing better to do than just hike.
Yeah.
And we'd stop and film some flowers. And I came back and just started editing on iMovie on my phone. And I posted it to Instagram and everybody's like, dude, that's so sick. And I'm like, yeah,
so you didn't even know that you had
it. I had no idea. Literally learned everything I know from YouTube. And I've spent thousands and thousands of hours on YouTube.
Yeah.
YouTube University. So, and yeah, the filming thing, it was just kind of like, I don't watch a lot of TV, but I really love watching like YouTube and seeing like, say like snowboarding videos or surfing videos. And I've always felt that like fishing is kind of just missing something like that. And, I think fishing is just more like people kind of look at it as like, oh yeah, here, let me watch this tip video on how to throw this bait. And, you know, and fishing, I think fishing is cool. And I'm tired of people asking me like, oh, you fish? Oh, that's cool. Like, what's that about? It's like, well, here, I'm going to make a video and I'll show you how I think it's cool.
Yeah.
And,
well, you make it look like your people are there. Like you get you people to fucking experience like your videos.
There's so many little moments in fishing. That's what it is.
The day, it's wild.
That's
know?
Like, I mean, when I try to make my own shit, kind of like I look at yours for, some inspiration.
Yeah.
And I mean, I really think you do some great shit. Like, I'm like, this is how it should look.
Yeah.
Or something should.
And that's how you learn. You know, I pull stuff from other industries and, you know, other creators too. Like you just talked to Brandon, like Kyle Vandiver, his filmer is crazy good. You know, and that you guys all feed off each other and everybody gets ideas and it's cool. So the game's kind of changing, progressing, and it's not just going to be just about tip videos. It's going to be like, I think bass fishing has a long ways to go. Like, look at fly fishing. Have you ever watched like fly fishing videos?
Fuck, dude. Gay.
They're super cool. No. Hey. A bass tournament was just one on a fly rod.
Yes, Shasta. It was.
But no, but like, you know, I just feel like bass fishing is, I don't know what it is. There's just not a lot of guys that are like into the filming yet, but they're going to get there. Like GoPros, a lot of people are doing that kind of stuff. But
I cannot fuck. Okay, the new GoPro, different story. The old shit, I cannot stand.
Did you just say someone won on a fly GoPro rod?
At Shasta.
Did they? Did
the team,
really?
The Wild West team.
Oh, gotcha. I thought you said Michaels. Yeah. I know Michaels won
no
that.
No way.
Yeah.
I believe it. Float and fly?
I guess that's the rumor. I mean, I didn't.
Well,
you know,
float
you know,
and fly. Yeah, I believe
no,
it.
Not a float and fly, like on a fly rod.
Throwing a floating fly?
Some sort of fly, yeah,
some
I would imagine.
Some sort of fly.
Some sort of fly.
Yeah, so that was like a month ago, but yeah.
I believe it.
And how long have you been actually like filming? Like where you got a camera, you kind of started editing.
Okay, so what it was one of my best friends, Pat Tuohy, he was like, hey, dude, I'm going to fish the Bassmaster Opens. He's like, I'm going to go out east. I need a co-angler to sign up with me. And I was like, I'll do it. And I'd always wanted somebody to film me fishing. I was always like telling my buddies that were like, you know, say down in LA. And I was like, dude, come on, you got to come to the lake and film me fishing. And it never worked out. I've had a couple of them come out and they were just like, didn't get it, whatever. So after he said he was going to go fish the opens and I was going to fish as a co-angler, I literally had enough money to buy a camera and a drone. And then I had to borrow money from my brother to buy a laptop. So then I go out east and I'm fishing as a co-angler.
You don't want me asking, what camera and drone did you buy?
Sony A6500 was my first camera
ever.
That's
your first camera?
Yeah.
It's a nice camera.
It's a nice camera. That's the one Paul has.
I got one now too. And yeah. Because Johnny referred it, it's
well. No, this is great because people will listen and they watch shit, so they're gonna go.
I have the A63X NL400.
Oh, that's a great one. That is a great one.
That's the best one.
Yeah. The flux capacitor. Yeah, the
flux. I'm like, you start talking to this camera, like, what the fuck is he talking about?
Yeah, so I just kind of went out there, just bought it, and literally had no, I knew how to use iMovie, which is very basic. Had no idea how to set up the camera except turn it on. And while we were practicing, I just filmed and ended up doing pretty good in that tournament and making, I got second and won $6,500, paid my brother back, and started editing that video slowly after work. And like 2.5 months later, I put it out and everybody's like, dude, this is so cool. And I was like, thanks, man. Like, I tried really hard. You guys check out that Zoom transition I put in there. You know? And so people kind of liked it. And then I just kind of like held on to that. And I was like, dang, like this, you know, people think this is cool, just like I think it's cool. And so I've only been doing it for like 3 years.
Which is amazing.
Damn,
because
really?
You 3 years. Wow. You make a living off of it.
Yes.
Right?
I just started going full time. So
dude,
I just started, awesome. I went out east to film with the Zaldane. So Chris and Trait Zaldane. And we filmed a series for Bassmaster's YouTube channel for the Bassmaster Elite series and every other tournament they're on. And it was sponsored by Amazon. So Amazon's a huge sponsor to get into fishing. So we put out 7 episodes.
Yo, Amazon, what's up? You know, podcast. What's
up, Amazon? Hit us up, Amazon.
Yeah, so next year I'm going back. He's going to Florida to fish his professional events. He's going to be there first week of February, I think.
I think I'll be there. Yeah, I'm gonna stay next week and go play around for sure.
Yeah.
Well, don't tell the lady.
You're fishing. Oh, she's actually gonna fly out.
Oh wow.
You Ooh. Go. You fish. If you in Florida in February, you better fucking hang out for a couple of weeks, because I tell you what, that is, it's the only other place that's equivalent to California is I think there in Texas. And in February, it's hard to leave.
Yep. And yeah, so then I'll be traveling with the Zaldanes. I know Trade's gonna be fishing her opens. Chris is gonna be fishing the Elite Series and. And I'm going to find some time to fish an open circuit too.
You also do you've done some AFCO videos. You've done.
Yeah.
Yeah. You do a lot of little, like what other stuff have you worked
on? Shout out AFCO.
So what I cut my teeth doing was there's two separate stories, but so my first thing I ever did was I filmed Carl Jochumsen at the US Open, the US hello, Open, hello, mate. Me and my mate, we were running around like me.
And, God, Johnny could go all day. Yeah. I swear, if I told him he needs to make a YouTube channel and
strictly
just
in British,
strictly in Australian, because he will fool everybody.
I'll just tell the rest of the story like this, mate. So.
Do it. Don't talk about it. Be about it.
So we went out there and I met Carl over there at the US Open, and I literally had just bought like this really crappy wireless microphone, and I had no idea how to use it. I just plugged her in and. Went out there, and I was sleeping in my car in the parking lot.
Did you say me car?
My car. I think that was a little bit like Irish or something, but I'm going to tell the rest. But so I was just sleeping in the car. It's like 100 degrees at night. And so I'm just filming Carl, just kind of letting him do his thing. I'm kind of quiet.
They
so
requested for you to do this.
No, I hit him up. Okay. So that's like the other thing with filming too that people need to realize. When you first start, you got to do stuff for free. And I'll tell you the rest of this, okay? Dude. So I was like, should I spend $2,000 to like, you know, hit up guys, or sorry, to fish the tournament, or should I film somebody? And I was like, I should just film somebody. Who's going to be there? And I actually hit up Trait first, and she couldn't go because she was getting surgery. And I was like, who else seems cool that's going to be there? And I was like, Carl Jochumsen. So I hit him up and filmed him.
How long ago was this? When was this?
This was in 2017.
Oh, wow. Damn.
I think it was 2017, yeah. So, but here's where the story gets good. So I put out that edit, and then Carl calls me up. He goes, mate, I got a gig for you. And I'm like, what? He goes, how would you think about, you know, traveling with me on the FLW tour? Have FLW pay for you to fish the co-angler side, throw you some money for some tip videos, and you come film me during practice, and I'll pay you some money. And I was like, oh, yeah, I'm in.
sign me up.
Thank you. And so that's where I started, like, just filming kind of part-time. And then the AFCO thing happened at the same time. So AFCO did this competition called Bass Boot Camp.
Mm-hmm.
And what it was a video competition where people from all over the United States would put in these 1-minute videos to AFCO to prove to them that they would be a good representative of the company. And AFCO would pay your way to fish a Bassmaster Open Circuit, which is like semi-pro qualifying for the Bassmaster Elite Series.
Mm-hmm.
So right when I head out east, I'd entered in my video, and then I get the call or email, I don't even remember what it was, from Matt Florentino, who's been on the podcast.
Yeah, he's a buddy.
He's a super cool guy. Yeah. And he's like,
shout out AFCO.
Yeah, shout out AFCO. We're all AFCO here too.
Hey, everybody. Same here, dude. They've been a help to the podcast too. So
their stuff is legit as
it gets. Legit. I mean,
100%.
But for that first whole year, I was filming for Carl, filming for FLW, and then AFCO was paying for me to fish the Opens. So I fished the tour as a co-angler and fished the Opens as a pro and did a whole vlog series with AFCO. And that was kind of how I learned to use a camera. Like, literally, I had no idea how to use it. I just would point and shoot.
Imagine when he knows what he's doing.
Dude, yeah, scary. I'm getting there. I'm kind of getting close.
I don't know how it gets better.
Did FLW want you to film?
Yes.
As well? Like, did you turn that down?
What they wanted me to do was they wanted me just to film tip videos. But then what I did was I took it a step further, and they do marshals. So everybody just gets to go ride with the top 30 guys on cut days. And I was like, why would I just film tip videos? Like, I could learn fishing, ride with one of the guys that made the cut, and film for FLW doing that. So then I started doing that, and those got traction, and just always getting creative with it.
Yeah. I think that's the key thing that you 100%.
Said is 100%. I'm serious. Like, being creative. I mean, yeah.
You got to do shit for free in the beginning. Like,
yes.
There's you got to build an audience. Like, I've done this, I'm 154 fucking episodes.
Yeah.
I have a Patreon. That's how my sponsor works right now. Sometimes I have them, sometimes I don't.
Yeah.
This is free. I'm fucking driving up here to you guys because that's what you got to do. I don't like Zoom. We wouldn't have this call.
I wouldn't have
done
it.
And over the phone, it just does not work as good. Like,
I'd have been in my fucking underwear for sure.
There's some dudes that you can, you know, like, that's very professional, but you're not going to get this same fuck around that.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Not at all.
So it's kind of like, I think a key point that you hit is, like, sometimes you just got to do shit for free.
Get a portfolio going.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's like slinging weed when you first start slinging weed. You know, you throw out a couple extra nugs, keep them coming back, and then you start hitting them with the real price. You know what I mean?
It's a great story, though, because I feel like a lot of people follow you, too. And you know, you're kind of saying, this is what I did. And it's the new trend.
Yeah.
Everyone's making a fucking video now. And not some are great, some suck.
But you have to separate yourself, and that's what Johnny does. I feel like you could watch his video and 10 other videos, and the one you remember is Johnny's video. Why? Because it comes down to passion. He would love to do this. Yeah, so when you love to do something, you do it better.
It's crazy because your videos look like the dude's videos that actually have done it for 10, 15 years.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Oh, dude, I live at that computer. Like, that was the thing.
Are you doing anything through Premiere? Did you learn how to
Premiere? I use Final Cut.
Oh, sorry.
Which is kind of like don't talk about Premiere here, dude.
Oh. Yeah, this is anti-Premiere. Yeah, I'm a Final Cut guy.
I'm a Premiere guy. So
He had Premiere. He deleted it.
Again, I have no idea what the fuck either one of you guys are talking about right now.
Apparently, we know who his video guy is.
I can barely catch a fucking fish, let alone edit a video.
You got to give it the time. Get a pull over here. He's starting his fucking YouTube channel.
Yeah.
My gosh, dude.
I'm too busy sleeping, man.
To know what goes into making a good edit, and I think that's why I've held off from YouTube so long, is because I don't want to just do a half-ass edit. Yeah. And I've done plenty of those already and put them up on YouTube, you know. But
you're learning.
I'm learning, you know. But then again, you know, everybody's doing that. And so the route I'm going to go now is I'm going to hit them with something they haven't seen. And when they see it, they're not going to be ready for it. Yep. And that's where we're going now.
And you can't
give us a sneak peek?
You can't fake a good story.
It's going to be badass.
Yeah.
It's just
we'll show you some after this.
Yeah, we'll give you a little sneak peek before
you
leave.
Could you give us, how about any kind of, you don't want, I know you don't want anyone to grab your idea, but can you kind of say what you have planned a little bit?
Yeah, 4K, 120 frames a second, big swim baits, nothing under 5 pounds.
Damn.
There you go.
Boom. That's it. Shout out AFCO. Hold on.
That was a mic drop, guys, just saying.
Yeah, and that's our goal. You know, we're going to, you know, nobody had ever seen anything like the posse when we did the posse. And so
You have that in mind as well.
Yeah, we're just creating art. That's what we want.
We're just creating something that nobody's seen yet, and we want to make it better than anybody's
done. Giving people what
they
need, not what they want, what they fucking need.
Fucking need, exactly.
You know what I mean? It's not what they want, it's what they need. Yeah.
You're going to eat it, and you're going to like it.
That's it.
Who do you guys think, as a video part, is doing a good job right now?
Doing a good job. There's a lot of facets to it, right? Like, there's guys like Brian Latimer who does a great job of informing, you know.
But the video quality is not there.
Video quality, Brandon Polnick.
Yeah.
Because he's the best.
Brandon blows everybody out of the water.
Yes.
Yeah. Brandon has a very similar vision, and he's accomplished so much more, and he's at that place where he can really
Does he do all of his own?
No. Well, he definitely has a creative input, but Kyle is very talented.
Yeah.
Kyle Vandiver is insanely good.
He has a full-time, pretty much, film guy. Just, that's crazy.
Which is what me and the Zaldanes are going to do next year. So and it's this
so
year.
Much work. It's so a lot much, of work. I don't think, like, and I, it goes back to it. Nobody knows what goes into this until you sit down and watch Johnny do what he does, because your whole life is reliant on Final Cut. And Final Cut, Final Cut, Final Cut.
Not
and
Premiere, Final Cut.
Not Premiere, yeah. Final Cut.
Premiere,
and,
no.
And people don't know the hours that
throw
go
that
into
Premiere
editing.
In the fucking trash.
Yeah,
right now.
Seriously, if you've got Premiere, just chuck it, because it's no good. But yeah, the people don't know the hours and hours that go behind. To make a 15-minute edit probably took me 48 hours behind my computer. No joke, to make one 15-minute edit that I thought was pretty cool.
And then what happened when Johnny saw it?
And then when Johnny saw it, Johnny said, bro, that's cool. But you could see the look in his eye where it was like, dude, this sucks, bro. So, and I still put it out because, I mean, it was my first edit. You know, I was like, I put so much time. I can't just trash this thing.
If you look at my first edits, they're worse than everybody's
so
first are bad.
Too.
Yeah, I mean, I edited the whole Big Bait Posse. I produced and edited that
so
whole thing.
So you know how to edit, but you were doing it analog at the time. It wasn't.
It was analog. It was the first year that HD had
were
even
you using
been
Premiere?
Introduced. And we were actually.
Probably Final Cut.
No. In the beginning, we used Premiere, and then we got the very first Mac Pro to ever come out. And then we had to go to Final
Game
Cut.
Changer.
But that's what we did for that one. But the editing for a motorcycle clip back then was, it consisted of a cut and a splice together with the next and a cut and maybe a fade in between. There's
some LBZ videos with gutter mouth behind them.
Yes, you know, some Moto Triple X, you know, and that's what it was. It was the Moto Triple X crew is who helped me do the Big Bait Posse, you know.
Oh, did they really?
I got all
oh,
the music
shit.
Rights from those guys. Nice. And whatnot, you know. But to do what Johnny does now is 100 times harder than what we did with the Posse.
Because the shots, the film.
I walked in earlier and he was on the computer and I'm literally sitting behind him and he's got this screen pulled up with fucking numbers, buttons, levers. And I'm looking at him like, you getting ready to fly a fucking airplane? Like, yeah. it's what it looked like to me. I said, I don't know how in the fuck you can look at that and like, put your helmet on. Like, that's what it felt like to me. I looked at it and I felt like I was missing my fucking helmet. I'm not kidding you, dude.
It's like we know how you fish now, too. Yeah, you beat the fuck out of them, right?
Absolutely.
Beat them.
Let's go back to your previous career, Aaron.
Oh, God, 14 seconds of it.
Did you fight? You fought for a while, though.
No, I fought one time.
You've seen the video. Everybody's seen the video.
So here's the story of MMA. So first of all,
no, did you train for a while?
I trained for 3 months, and I didn't even want to fucking do that. I just wanted
to go.
You
like fucking fought MMA for a long time.
Well, I fought a lot. Just illegally.
Just not legally. You know?
MMA is like is fucking second love. I mean, I've been watching mixed martial arts since I was fuck 8 years old. I had my dad, he's taking me to rent, you know, Shamrock fighting chemo back
pride,
in the day.
Pride
days. Yeah, pride was cool, but then now you get soccer kicking people in the fucking head and stomping on them. It's not to people who don't understand the sport, it's entertaining, but for someone who doors it, it's gross. You shouldn't be able to fucking stomp on someone's head.
What about pancreas? Right. Did you like...
What's that?
Pancreas shots.
Oh,
yeah.
They did the open fist like Boss Rude.
Well, Boss Rude used to fuck people up with the open fist. Yeah, he was nasty. But I've always had a love for it. And I had a buddy that fought full time, and I was his corner man. And for, God, 3 or 4 fights, I'd corner him, and I watched the whole fight card. And I'd get done, I'd look at him, I said, dude, I feel like I could beat these guys up, dude. I was like, they don't look tough to me. I feel like I could fuck them up. He's like, well, do one. I'm like, fuck, all right. You know, so I walked at about, at the time, 188, and I cut down to, which I thought was supposed to be a catch weight at 175, and I got down to 175 morning of the fight. Sanction calls me, goes, yeah, just make sure you can be at 170. I go, 170? And I'm a little motherfucker as it is. I'm like, I'm going to go lose 5 pounds in 2 hours. You're out your fucking mind. So I went to the gym, fucking on the sauna, did push-ups, and lost 4 pounds, weighed in at 171. And, you know, I quit smoking, quit drinking. We got in the best shape of my life, went out there. And in fact, the guy I was supposed to fight backed out 2 weeks before.
So you got a different dude.
I got a different dude. Oh. The guy I was supposed to fight was a debuter. He's never fought before. And the guy goes, yeah, the guy backed out, but we got this guy. He's 4-0. He's the head boxing coach over at LA Galaxy. Are you down to fight him? I said, fuck, man. My two things were, I didn't want to get kicked in the face, and I didn't want to fight a black person. That was just fucking, those are my two things. You know? They're just way more athletic than we are. Cut the shit. You know what I mean? So that's a joke. That's obviously a joke. I'm like 85% serious on that. But so they got 4-0, and I go, well, fuck, I've sold 300 tickets to all my, I had homies flying in from all over the country, and I said, fuck it, I'll fight them, you know, so. Yeah, I'll never forget it. Showed up at the rink, weighed in 171 next day. Showed up at the fight, had a cup on. I remember walking to the cage. I walked out to Phil Collins in the air tonight. Do 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 do.
That's the best.
I couldn't feel it, and I was jacked up, nervous as fuck. Went to the center of the ring, touched gloves. I remember touching his glove, and I remember it felt like he just grew, like Mario ate a fucking mushroom. Like, and I remember staring at him, and I remember thinking my cardio was fucking shot. Like, I've been in fuck 100 street fights, and I got
too much.
I got about 2 minutes in me. If I don't fucking knock you out in 2 minutes, someone's going. You know, I just run out of gas. And I remember touching gloves, and I see him back up, and I said, "Fuck, someone's going to sleep." Like someone's going night night. You know what I mean? And 14 seconds in, he throws an inside left leg kick. I drop both of my hands, which literally walking out before the fight, my corner man goes, "Whatever you do, the guy, you know, he's known to kick leg kicks. Just check it, which means pick your leg up and use your shin as opposed to eating it in your thigh." The kicks are like when you hear those real loud slaps, those are the ones you don't hear thud. Those are the ones that you fucking that hurt.
Right, right.
So he throws an inside leg kick, and I go down and I block it with not only one of my hands but both of my fucking hands, and then come up and we both knock each other out the exact same time, 14 seconds in the round.
What was it called?
My record 0-0-1, so it's a no contest.
No way.
It's a video.
Yeah, the video is out. I went viral. Got
a
million.
You ever seen it where they both knocked each other? Yeah.
My buddy calls me 2 days later. He goes, "Dude, you were just on fucking Jay Leno." I'm just like, "What?" We got on Tosh.0. On Tosh.0, Sports Center, Sports Nation. It went viral.
They didn't message you or nothing.
No, I got paid from YouTube, from the views. And then with the fucked up part about it was that we were supposed to get $2,000 for knockout of the night. And we had to fucking split it, dude. Oh, how stupid is that?
That sucks.
I got $1,000.
That's crazy. It was but, fucking Jay Leno.
It was because at the time it was the second time in the history of the sport that two people have simultaneously knocked with hands. Now, there's been times where guys, you know, like Matt Hughes took down Carlos Newton back in the old, had him up on the cage and went to go drop him, and Matt hit, you know, impact from the guy slamming his head, and Matt hit his own head. That's happened a few times, but as far as punches at the same time, it's the second time it ever happened. And now it's happened two or three times since then. It's back 2013, but. MMA is fucking, speaking of MMA, big fight tomorrow night, Poirier and McGregor, man. I'm pulling for Poirier. I hope he fucking cleans his clock.
I'm not a McGregor
either.
Fan
I'm a fan of McGregor's athletic ability, but his off the octagon attitude is, I'm all about sportsmanship.
I'm a Khabib guy.
Fucking love Khabib. He mauled that motherfucker too, and he's acting like, if you didn't know who Conor McGregor was and the way he talks, you would think he never fucking lost. So you got choked. You got choked unconscious, and then you get, and then he jumped fucking the cage and beat up one of your fucking corner men after fighting you for 20 minutes, dude. Fuck Dylan Danis too. Yeah. I would never say it to his face, but fuck him. I hate that guy so much.
Hey, Dylan, we're just kidding.
Just kidding, Dylan. I love you, man. But no, MMA has been it's.
Does anyone ever notice you from, like, say, fishing the series? Has everyone go, "Fuck, bro, you were in that video a lot"?
No. When it first happened, kind of.
Yeah.
But I've actually told people about it, and like, "You're that." Like, they've seen it, but they didn't know. I had a lot less tattoos back then, and I don't think they knew. MMA, I live for it, dude. I love fishing, but MMA, it's just, I don't think people grasp what it takes to be a professional fighter. Like, it's like, I get emotional, like fishing, I get emotional.
Yeah.
MMA, I get emotional because I know what goes into do that. And I think people think, "Oh, he's the fighter." It's like, dude, you fucking leave your family for months at a time. You train, you diet, you're cutting 30 fucking pounds.
It's like fishing almost. Bro.
Dude, it's right? you're fucking all in, dude. You're all in.
You're all in.
And then the funny thing about that fight too, is I remember I had a really big tournament the week before that fight, and I fucking just bombed it. And I'll tell you why, is I remember fishing and all I could fucking think about was like, man, I got fucking 1 week. I got to strap on 4 ounce mitts and go.
Oh, my fucking, it's still connected to my phone. I'm like, why the fuck is it making all these noises? Ding, 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 ding. Sorry, cut
you off. You must be using Premiere. I had a big tournament beforehand, and I couldn't concentrate. All I could think about is I got to go get locked in a cage and fight this guy. And I've been in, like I said, hundreds of bar fights. And the difference between a bar fight is that, boom, they happen. Like, you don't prepare for them. Like, you know, when someone talks shit, bah, 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 it just fucking happens. And then cage fight, like, okay, you have a month to think about and prepare to go in the cage and strap on mitts and fight someone. You can't run anywhere. You can't go anywhere. So it's just like, and then I'm fighting someone who's fought 4 times, and, you know, he was a head boxing coach.
That's the shitty part.
Yeah,
I'm not a fucking slouch, but I'm not a professional boxing coach. Yeah. You know what I mean? And my stamina is like a fucking of an 8-year-old. You know, at best. You know, and I got done with that fight. I walked out and first I lit a fucking joint up. First thing I did was I smoked one. I said, "Man, like, I have out. To." This is a lot. And then they actually called me and wanted me to do it again because I put UBC on the map. I mean, that shit went fucking everywhere. And they're like, hey, man, you know. And then the fucked up thing was in the gym, they had all these cool pictures that night. And they didn't have one picture of me and this dude in the goddamn for years. I got mad at him. I threw a pen at the dude at the gym that day. But they offered me like fuck $3,000 or $4,000 to fight again. And I was like, dude, I'm a fisherman at heart. How about that rematch? I'm like, how about you fuck off? You know, how about you go fight, bro?
Yeah, you go.
And we're honestly too, like, if my cardio was better and I could just go in the cage and fight, I would more likely do that. But the fact preparing for a fight, training, in fact, I only trained once or twice a week. And one of the dudes like, dude, if you don't come and train with the team more often, you know, you're not going to fight. I'm like, fuck you, dad. Like, who are you to tell me when I get to come fucking train, dude? Like, I paid to fight too. I had to get a license. I had to buy my mitts. Shit. Oh yeah. It's like 300 fucking bones to go get knocked out in 14 seconds. You know what I mean?
And make 700 back, right?
Yeah. It's fucking silly. But, and I love it, man. I live for it. And yeah, the videos, if you guys want to peep it, it's on YouTube. 14 second double knockout. 5150's got the best version. I think it's 204, two minutes, 4 seconds.
Yeah.
So never again.
Cheers.
Yeah, yeah, right?
Cheers. Drinking Pacifico. Cheers.
Let's talk about your A-rigs, bro.
I do make those, don't I?
I make A-rigs as well.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. I started making them probably a year ago.
Okay.
Yeah, but I braise them. Do you braise them or crimp them?
I crimp them.
Crimp them?
Yep.
Do you think that makes a big difference? Do you think it's fine? I only braise them, though, because sand bass, dude.
Yeah, it depends on what you're fishing for. I was going for, obviously, we've got giants here at Clear Lake, you know. And I was going for longevity because everybody else's A-rig would break after 3, 4, or 5 fish, you know, bouncing them in the boat. And
yeah.
I've had 3 months out of one of my A-rigs, catching 30 a day. Yeah, so that was my goal with going with it. And I was sick of the wires pulling out. You know, or, you know, some flimsy wire that goes back and forth 4 times and then breaks.
Yes.
And so that was where I was going with mine. I wanted something that lasted longer, had thicker wires, I could throw bigger baits, and that it had more baits than anything out there on the market, because I noticed here, the more baits I put on it, the more fish I caught. So I just kept adding baits until it got feasibly not castable anymore. And I was like, all right, let's go back now a little bit. You know,
how many baits do you have from dummies and then the three?
There's 13 total on one. Yeah, so if you start putting 4.8s and 5.8s all over, you know, the thing becomes a literal mess. It's hard to cast. It becomes not fun to fish at that point. So I usually stick the little 2.8s on the inside teasers.
Kitex or something?
Yeah, a little 2.8s or 3.8, you know, Gancraft, a Kitex. You know, honestly, anything. If it kicks, it works. That's what I tell people.
Yeah.
And then I'll put some 4.8s on the bottom, kind of have one of every size in that school, because – I don't know if you see a shad school around, you know, it's usually the little guys are on top flicking around and all the big ones are underneath, you know, so I set up my ball the same way and I started jacking them. And I mean jacking them, dude. It was dumb.
When did you start making that A-rig?
God, I was probably making that thing 6 years. I didn't sell it to anybody for a good 3 years.
He caught a nine on the same. Paul and I fished a derby to be team partners a couple years ago. We were fishing a derby and we had one spot where we wanted to get on so fucking bad. And these guys just were just fucking in the way. We're fishing the narrows and fuck, we see that boat go flying away. And Paul's like, dude, it's open. So we fucking, we smash over there. First or second cast, Paul fires out there, sinks one out in about 28 feet, starts whining it. And he just goes, poof. He goes, dude, biggin'. And when Paul says biggin', I'm telling you, 9 out of 10 times, it's a biggin'.
Yeah, his
rod's doubled. So what I do, I go to drop my fucking rod and I throw it in the water. That's how excited I was. I reach over the fucking boat, end up getting my rod, almost fall in, get the net out. Paul's got a fucking 10 and a 7 on the same fucking cast. Same cast.
That was during a tournament.
It was in a tournament.
During a derby.
In a tournament. It was like a 9 and a 6.
Whatever the fuck it was. It was 17 pounds of fish in one cast.
So it's not a 10, dude.
Either way, you're happy.
Dude, it was ridiculous. But yeah, no, and that's right when I started. After that, I realized, dude, this thing's pretty cool. Mm-hmm. You know? But yeah, no, I want to finish Aaron's story, because this guy literally, I set the hook on that 9 and that 6, and I said, Aaron, I can't turn the handle, and I turn it once. Aaron, I can't turn the handle. This thing's giant, dude. I don't know what the heck I have. Meanwhile, Aaron is in the lake at this point.
You jumped in.
I know. I was hanging. I was 50% in.
Yeah, he's 50% in the lake.
And I'm all, Paul, grab me. He's like, I can't.
Yeah, he's like, grab me. And meanwhile, I got a 9 and a 6 on a rod, and we're in a tournament with 10 minutes to go. Okay. Yeah.
Literally.
Yeah, literally. And so somehow the fish comes up and I look and I see it's 2 when they're on the top and I go, Aaron, it's 2. And I turn and I'm just winding. And all of a sudden I turn to the left and Aaron's right there with the net soaking wet and then go right into the net. And I just go, what just happened? Like, what, you fell in the lake. I caught two fish at once. We got to go, dude. We got to go. And it turned into full chaos. Yeah.
Threw back 2 3-pounders. And I don't think we won it, but we finished. I think
yeah,
it was
we were third.
That was on this, on Clear Lake?
Yeah.
Clear,
yeah.
Damn,
yeah.
Dude.
Chaos.
Will you throw big baits during tournaments?
Oh, shit. Oh, yeah. Paul will have not a single fish in the fucking live well at 1 o'clock, and I promise you that fucking big bait is in his hand, dude. I've experienced. I'm like, Paul, threw pigs. He's like, Britt. I'm gonna get bit, and he gets bit.
Yeah. I fish a lot of tournaments with big baits. This last FLW that just came here in the fall, I was getting bites in practice on a 6.8 and a 7.8 on a 10-aught beast, and I made my mind up. I had one little rattle trap school. I was gonna go catch my 10 to 13 pounds in the morning just to get comfortable and calm, and I was gonna go throw that swimmer. And I threw that swimmer for 2 days straight, and I probably caught 16 fish on it in 2 days, and I weighed in 15.5 pounds a day. Because some days you just don't throw it in front of a big one.
There's a time of year up here where it doesn't matter what you throw, you catch the same size fish. Usually there's a technique or a place you can go to target a big one. There's certain times of year where you just don't. If they bite, they bite. You can't target them necessarily.
And
which
they all
is
eat
frustrating.
Big baits.
And yeah. They all eat small baits. It doesn't. You catch the same fish on Ned Rig. It's just tough.
Yeah. So I love throwing a swim bait. So I'm obviously going to look there first. But I know from being and living here for so long that if that's what you want to do every tournament, you're going to donate, you know, someone's going home with your paycheck most of the time.
Yeah.
So, I use my brain, you know, when I'm fishing tournaments, you know, I don't just commit to a swim bait. You know, a lot of guys will say, oh, I went big. I don't care the fuck who you are. Who didn't go big and try to win that tournament too? You say, exactly. You know, I tried to win. Well,
yeah, me too.
Yeah, guess what? So did I, and I had a little freaking worm on. So, you know, we're all trying to accomplish the same thing, and so I will, but I'm not stupid. I'm not going to go donate, you know, that I do got to make a living right now. So I tend to use my brain, but I am not scared to commit. And
he doesn't get frazzled either. A lot of guys, I've fished with Paul for several years as a team partner. You know, I'm the one on the boat. I'm just freaking the fuck out. Paul's like, Britt, goose, bravo, you be okay. And he fishes calmly, which at the end of the day, I tell people mental fishing is 20% skill and fucking 100,000,000% mental.
Yep, yeah,
that's it. You know what I mean? That's all it is.
Especially throwing big baits and grinding it out, you know?
Yeah, you exactly. Can't.
Yeah, there's times where I'm like, fuck this, I'm done. You know?
Right. Which is like 5 casts for me.
See, I know the lake so well, and this will happen to everybody after you know an area or you know, a lake or multiple lakes very well. It was like that on Casitas. It's like that on Berryessa too. I know that somewhere on that lake, we got a lot bigger lakes than down in Southern California. Yeah. So somewhere on the lake, it's happening. You have to time it right, and you've got to get a lot lucky. People don't realize bass fishing is, I've heard people say these numbers. In my mind, it's 50% good and 50% pure luck.
Really?
Yeah, because 50% of the time I can call my shot. The other 50% of the time it was pure luck.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's the way fishing is. You know, you can only get so good. You'll never perfect it. Fish are going to get smart. Yeah, as we get smarter and we throw different baits at them, they adapt, you know, and they get smarter and start looking at different baits.
And in my opinion, what makes a fisherman a good fisherman is understanding bass. Like you're skipping a fucking worm you're good, but understanding what fish do, when they do it, why they do it. Once you start getting inside, it's like a woman, right? We'll never fully fucking understand them. We'll never fully. But the more you understand about them and why they act the way they do, then you'll have a better understanding. And once it's like the same thing with fish, you know, you never understand it, but it's hard to get inside of a woman's brain. It's harder than fucked inside of a bass's brain too. You know what I mean?
It is.
Why is this fish in 42 degree water sitting in 4 feet on a tie spot? You know what I mean? Well, it's probably on her period. You know what I mean? That's kind of how it fucking works, dude.
Yeah. I mean, you can blame it on it every single time.
I knew that shit was coming up.
You got my wife in the background.
She threw a tampon at me.
How, when you talk about like the fish getting smarter, stuff changing, what have you seen different, like as you've been up here with the swim baits? Have you had to downsize? Have you had to change different baits? Look for something different?
Yeah, these fish have done a complete 180, 360, 540, 720, whatever you want to call it, from when I first moved here. I talk about the dumb and the old Clear Lake a lot, and they were really dumb, and Aaron can vouch for this because he was here when it was dumb. It was dumb. And when I say dumb, I mean any creek mouth you pulled up to in the month of March, you can bang 30 pounds if you knew the angle of the cast and you knew how they set up it.
In 5 casts.
And it was literally in 5 casts. Now, the last 5 years, you can run all 10 creek mouths and maybe not even land on a school that day.
You think that's pressure or the fish getting smarter?
No, we had a big die-off. About 5 years ago, we had a big die-off, and it happened for 3 years in a row. And
zero grass, and I mean zero grass.
They killed everything and anything they could see growing in this lake, and they sprayed and sprayed and sprayed. And then it, all of a sudden, the water was 87 degrees one day, and they were still spraying. And all of a sudden, we went up north, and a whole bay from a tule point to a tule point,
could walk
from
across
the edge of the tules to 50 feet out, were dead 5 to 10 pounders.
We were watching fish die as we were fishing, literally floating up, dying.
Yeah, we're watching. Aaron found this school, okay, and he goes, dude, I found the mega school, bro. And this is in the middle of while they're all dying. I mean, you can literally, you'll catch a 6 pounder and a 7 will float up dead right next to it while you're fighting it, and just take its last breath.
Yep.
And we had hundreds and thousands of these 5 to 10 pounders just floating everywhere. And our population of giant fish got completely wiped out. There's still a lot in here. It's not like it got completely wiped out. I like to say 25% of them lived. So we've got enough genes.
I'd agree with that.
We got enough genes in this lake to still be weighing 30 pound bags, 35 pound bags, you know. But it's not the top 10 in a 50 boat tournament. Everybody has 30 pounds because that's what it was. If you didn't hit 30.
Now what are you looking at, 20?
We're looking at if you've got 22, you're guaranteed getting paid.
Okay.
Certain tournaments, it takes 22 to win. But usually somebody's banging 28 to 29 on a consistent basis on this lake.
Which are still insane statistics.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, insane. And I've been all over the country listening when I tell you this. I've been to Gunnersville. I've been to Okeechobee. I've been to Chickamauga, right? And they're Great Lakes, right? This motherfucker here, I'm telling you. And people that say those lakes are better, they've never been here.
Yeah, they've never been to Clear Lake.
This lake, bar none. And for being as small as it is, like this lake to people is big, but you go out east, fuck, you fish 3 days. You don't even get to fish an arm. Yeah. It's
for California, this is a very big lake.
But this lake,
right?
I've been everywhere. I've been to places in February, March, April. I've been there in October, November. This place fucking is when it's going, there's not you catch 40 in a row on the same cast. I mean the same cast.
I mean,
nowhere in the world ridiculous. Can you do that. I've been.
Yeah, me and Johnny this morning, we went out to film some swim bait stuff, and I pulled up to a spot, and you know, we fished the edge where I had got a couple bites the day before, and I hook one, lose it, you know, hook another one, lose it. And I look at Johnny and I was like, well, there should be more down there. That's two in a row, you know, and there wasn't anything there. And I turned around, I fired it off the other side of it, and we went 7 in a row, I think, on the swim bait. And that's how it is here. And when you find them schooled up, they're there because they're feeding. These fish, when they're not feeding, they swim out into the middle of the lake, and you can't catch them. And that's where they go. The lake's not deep, 40 foot out in the middle of the lake. You can go 10 miles across the middle of the lake, 25 foot deep. And these fish just swim around the mud when they don't want to chase and get on that bank, and that's what they do.
How many fish Paul's caught literally where he just fucking just fires one out in the middle? I mean, literally the middle.
The middle of the
and
lake.
7 pounder. I mean, it's unbelievable. This lake is all about angles. I've never been to a lake where I think angles plays a bigger part than here. Fuck. Really? I mean, not even close. And I learned that from Paul. I've experienced it. You know what I mean? It's quite unbelievable to. And I still learn from them. I mean, and that's something too, is when you go fishing, you ain't fucking fishing, man. Yeah, you have to learn. Yeah, and you can't act like you know everything, but no one does. You know, you got to be open-minded. And he certainly is almost perfected, the swim bait game. It's a pretty insane thing to watch.
And when you go fishing with Paul, he's constantly teaching you, you're on a guide trip.
Exactly.
That's in my blood.
Are you in guide mode a lot of the time? Just because
100%.
It's not even guide. It's Paul mode. That's just who he is. It's Paul. Not like he's trying. Yeah. It's just what he does.
He'll sit down on your boat. You'll be both fishing as far as just sit down and be like, all right, just
pound a Mountain Dew.
Make sure you cast to the right of that rock pile over there. And you're like, oh, okay.
Or he'll be like, hey, don't cast there. There's a tree. I'm like, yeah, I'm sure there is. Fuck, I'm hung up. He's like, I told you there was a tree there.
Like this morning, you know, I think I caught 6 or 7 in a row, and I set the thing down. I was like, I'm getting my camera out, Johnny. Get your bait in there quick, you know. And he throws it in there, and I noticed he missed like 15 feet to the left of where I was actually landing my bait, sinking it down. There's a group of little rocks down there. And
he didn't say anything. He just watched for 30 minutes.
No, dude,
missed the spot.
I let him make 3 casts to say, oh well, you know, maybe I just because I didn't throw it there, you know. But that's how specific I personally get with, dude, you missed by 15 feet, like. Not going to get a bite right there.
Yeah.
And that's just me. And I tell him too, I said, hey dude, see the last bubbles on the right? I was like, that's where I was landing mine. And that's just me, you know, like not just going to let somebody. That's just how I am, you
know? Oh, yeah.
I actually have a really funny story about that. So I was fishing FLW series one time at Orville, and it's a co-angler. And obviously you're fishing for your own fish. So, you know, I don't ever backseat anyone. Never would, never have, won't do it. We were fishing the inlet up the Middle Creek. I think it's called Bean Creek, comes in at Orville, and we're fishing a float and fly. And we're both, I got the boat sideways. We're both thrown and I'm letting him throw into the fucking fall, blah, blah. And his bobber was just fly. The eye of the hook was stuck to his bobber. So when he would throw the bobber in there, it just stayed afloat. And he's like, man, he's like, I don't think mine's sinking him. And he didn't realize it. And I'm just fucking just jacking him. mine's sinking like 9 feet. My bobber tip over and I'd catch one. And I let him do it for 30 minutes. I never told him because I'm like, fuck, I don't want him to catch it. If you're that dumb to not realize that you're, yeah. that, you know, that's yep. on you, homeboy. That's on it. You. And you're fishing for a smile. Now, if it's a team tournament, bro, you're a fucking idiot. Take your shit out. But it's like, dude, those are my fish. So I'm giving you a chance. I got the boat sideways. Like, just figure it out. And he obviously never caught one. And I caught like, fuck, I think like 13 pounds. And like,
but you're fishing, you know,
for money. It was a fish for money. Yeah. And again, and I've never backseat someone. I've been so fortunate. Even like on guide, like, I just never really had an idiot on board. I mean, you know, not that I can really remember. I've been real fortunate.
When people come up here to guide with you guys or that they're getting a guide trip with you, usually they know what they're doing, right?
For the most part. I think Paul's much more busy than I am up here. He's obviously a well-known name, but I think Paul gets a more bigger variety. I think people, I get a lot of people who, you know, want to fit, you know, I'm a pro angler, they want to come up and they want to learn, they want to see the places I fish. And I think that they want to learn about this lake. And a lot of the times it's like, you know, you want to take them to places where you catch fish, but
you're getting good guys that are rookies sometimes.
Or guys that fucking fish up all the time, but just want to, where are you fishing? Like, you know,
I take a lot of tournament guys out.
Yeah.
You know?
A lot of them. I do. Like they'll hire Paul and I for their practice, you know?
Right before the tournament.
Yeah. And it's hard to take them to your
shoe.
I take them right to the juice.
Yeah.
I say, here you go. This is what you do. You tie this on, you tie this on.
You're not fishing this. Sometimes you're not fishing the
tournament. No. I fish the FLW tournaments when they come and the open tournament. Okay. There's a team tournament here every weekend, whether it's a club tournament or regular team tournament. There's a team tournament here every weekend. So I take a lot of those guys out. The pro guys, not so much. They won't call me. They usually won't get a text back if they do. Come on, bro. Am I gonna text Ish, be like, hey dude, take me out on the FLW or take me out on the Delta tomorrow, you know, I need to go fishing, you know, I got FLW next month.
What's worse, the fact they're doing it or they don't realize what they're doing.
That's what gets me. I have got a lot of calls, but no, I take a lot of tournament guys out. I take them right to the juice because, to be honest with you, I've never had anybody conflict with what I'm doing. I'll take clients out 5 days a week. And the first guy I take out on Monday is staying the whole week. And I tell him, hey, listen, I'll be out Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. If you don't see me on a spot we fished, have at it. Mm-hmm. And they're like, oh, you sure? You sure? I won't go anywhere. I'm like, you're here for a week. This is what you came for. If I'm not there, take it. You know. And never once have I ever pulled up to a spot and said, hey, man, can I get my spot back? I've never had the conflict to even have to worry about it. So I take people straight to the juice and say, tie it on and fire it out there.
Will you get guys that just want to come straight for big baits with you?
Oh, 50% of the guys.
Really?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yep. I just teach them how I think about swim bait fishing. I can't guarantee we're going to catch anything. I'll try to get you here when your best chances are going to happen.
Guys understand that too, which is cool.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah. Everybody knows this.
They're like, what the fuck? We didn't catch one. It's like, you know what you're getting yourself into. You're a fisherman.
Throwing big baits, that's what's going to happen.
Yeah, that's it.
You catch one, cool. If not, I learned a bunch. You know what I mean?
Right. You're going to learn more from me in a day than you would fishing on your own for 2 years.
Agreed.
Watching YouTube.
Watching YouTube because you can't experience what's
going
on with your bait.
Which I think that's a different thing where editing, I feel like you could watch YouTube, watch them do that. With fishing, it's like you could tell me how to throw that bait. I can't feel
fishing
it,
someone else's water is the hardest thing on the planet.
You just can't feel it the way you were going to feel it.
That's it, dude. You know, the hardest thing I like to tell people, the hardest thing to do is to catch somebody else's fish, but I'm going to show you how I do it. Good luck. Good luck, because it works for some. Some people miss. Some people can take it and run with it at their lake. Some people just say, dude, what you taught me, they just don't do that.
It's like leaving the barber where your barber gets your hair all fucking nice and you can never fucking do it like that again.
That's
like,
it. That's exactly what it comes down to.
Same principle.
Yeah, that's it. You know, you can give them the bait. You can show them the angle. You can show them the line, the rod, everything, dude. But if they can't make that thing wiggle right, it ain't going to happen. And I put people in the best position I can, but I can't make promises.
No, it makes sense. Both you guys have to do that, right, too?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. Hey, I mean, it's like you said. I mean, at the end of the day, we get off on teaching people. Like, we share so much love and passion for the sport. We want people to learn. But it, like Paul touched on it, especially on tour, like, you can have someone, unless someone gives you a waypoint and says, this is where you need to stand, this is where you need to be, it's so hard to fish someone else's water. I mean, because you're out there and you're like, fuck, is this where I need to be? Like, you're guessing.
It's like a math equation.
You're guessing. Yeah. You're guessing. And when you're guessing, that's the worst thing. Yep. When you're fishing for money, I promise you right now, if you're guessing, dogs, stop.
Yep. Yeah. Stop. No, I mean, that's a hard one.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of it. I've tried.
I've tried it. I don't like it either. I think it never works.
Out of the 500 times someone's like, "Hey, go here and catch him," once maybe I'm like, "Fuck, he wasn't lying." Yeah. Other times I'm like, "Fuck this guy. This guy's a liar."
Yeah. Just
tell you the wrong shit. You know? Just
like, no way he was doing that.
Paul too, like his swim baits. Like I mean, it's there's a fine line between reeling it and reeling too fast. You know, he throws on a 5-1, and when he tells you to reel as slow as you can, it's insane. There's a constant bow in this cat's line. Like it is. His casts are a good one. Four or five minute casts.
Yeah, I've been timing him on the camera.
Especially with the HUD.
It's crazy. Yeah. It's crazy. Mm-hmm. And then other guy will, you know, the guy's in there wanting, and that's the difference between catching an 8, 9, 10 pounder nut. But they'll never.
Do you have patience for that? Will you throw the big swim?
Once
bait?
He showed you,
I will. But here's the thing: is that's Paul's life. Like when I go on tour, like we can catch them on big baits out there, but it's like I gotta know how to catch them on. You know,
no
chatting.
One's really. Throwing the big bait, rarely.
There's a few lakes where you definitely can do it. Okay. But
Zaldane throws it.
Zaldane throws it. You know really? What I mean? But now we got 2 days of practice on tour, so it's hard to. It's just hard. You know, if I were to go out and bust, you know, 18 pounds on the first day by 11, I might go pick something up. But even then, it's just I don't have the confidence. It's just Paul and I are he. It's just a confidence thing,
I think.
Yeah, for sure. No, it is. It definitely is. You know, but tour fishing, tournament fishing is so much different than you know, guiding. But then again, as you know, I'm fishing. Clear Lake's different. I think it's the only lake in the world where you can not put it down. And for at some point in the day, someone's going to fucking nibble it. You know what I mean? Someone's going to get it. But other lakes, it's like, it's just, you know, it's hard. It's tough.
You guys got to do a potty?
I don't. I just pissed my pants. I'm good. I'm like a NASCAR driver, buddy.
Here's a question for you, Paul. I've asked.
Yes.
I've asked 3 or 4 guys this. I've asked Oliver, Mike Gilbert. They both had different answers.
Right.
Do you think to be a successful swim bait fisherman, you need to know the basic techniques?
No, because there's that 50-50 factor of luck.
So you're the same. You could just pick up a swim bait and start learning that way.
No. I don't recommend that to anybody. I honestly don't. Don't recommend that to anybody because you're then. It's like chasing the dragon. You're just hoping to get lucky. You have no clue what you're doing. Now, if you start with the basics with your worm, your spinner bait, your jig, your jerk bait, now you're going to learn cadence, timing. You're going to learn what everything feels like on the bottom. I can't tell people enough. You're going to go spend $150 on a swim bait. You're going to throw that thing off the shore not knowing what's out there in front of your cast. Are you crazy?
Yeah.
So you're afraid to get it stuck.
Yeah.
You're not going to fish it right.
That's it. Go. You're not going to fish it right because you're afraid to lose it.
And then you lose it and you give up.
And then you lose it and you're broke. Exactly. So
fuck swim baits.
and a lot of people do that. But I recommend knowing your cast. And the only way you really know your cast is to, you know, I've learned half of this lake throwing crankbaits, swim baits, you know, other stuff like that. I've lost 500 HUDs on this lake. I can't tell you how many rocks I have found just because I got to go slow, feel what's down there, you know, but I did that knowing, okay, I got another box of HUDs coming. I don't recommend people doing that. You're going to lose all your tackle.
But at the same time, you're like searching the lake for what you want to find.
Yes.
With that HUD. It's almost like a search bait for you.
It's a search bait for me. Okay. Exactly. It really is. Because
where the fish live.
Right. Yeah. Right. I'm very finicky on where I want that thing to swim in the water column, whether it's next to a boulder in a cave or, you know, and the boat's got to be in the right spot. Everything's got
to
happen.
When we first started fishing together, Paul, he used to fish with our buddy Jackson, and he would be like, dude, Jackson gets mad at me because I take fucking 5 minutes just to set the boat up to where I want to go. And Jackson's on the front of the boat, just fucking cocked and ready to go. Like, dude, can we cast? He's like, nope, not yet, not yet. Get lined up. Because, you know, this is like an angle that comes down. You miss a fucking cast by a couple feet, it's a wrap. You just don't get bit.
Jake, be quiet, buddy.
Do you have a shitload of waypoints when you find that rock? Will you have like 5 waypoints around that to kind of surround it? Or do you just kind of...
Typically, no. What I do to set up, now everybody has their own way of graphing and using their graphing cards. I recommend a 0.1 puck on anybody's Lorentz setup or, you know, any sort of setup. If my German Shepherd doesn't stop woofing, we're going to fight. But I use the 0.1. So what I do is I then mark my target with the mark, and then I mark a full cast away from that target. And how I determine that is I zoom all the way in on the mark, and then leave the mark at the very top of my screen on the graph. And I know that my boat position being at the bottom of the screen on the graph zoomed all the way in is a full cast to that mark. So then I'll go ahead and lay another
mark.
That's smart.
See, I'm learning.
See, this is all from Newman. Newman's taught me all this. He's really good with the graphs. Yeah, so I lay a mark on the target. I lay a mark where I want my boat. If the wind's blowing out of the north, I go to the other side. I may make a mark if my wind, if the wind's blowing out of the south, that's where I'm going to hold on spot lock. And that's how I set it up. And then I use the point one, because the point one never lies to you. You're not guessing with it. It's going to draw that line off the front of your boat, and it's going to be like that 65 feet right in front of your boat. And I do, that's how I target fish on this lake and on every lake. And that's just how Matt taught me to do it.
But yeah.
A point on the where the wind usually comes from, a point where the rare wind comes from, so that I can set up on it in any condition and fish it correctly. And that's kind of how I use my electronics.
What you got a new boat?
I got a new boat.
What did you have before?
I have a Tracker jet boat, which I've had forever. Everybody knows me for that little Bass Tracker jet boat that I've been driving in for 15 years.
A lot
years.
Of money out of that puppy.
Oh, man. That sucker's paid for itself at least 9 times.
What size engine does it have?
My old one has a 175. My jet boat does. It's got a 175 inboard jet. So it's got Noltrax and the Graphs and the Point One and all that good stuff on it, too. But I ended up getting a Ranger, a Z520 Ranger.
Nice.
And, it was awesome for like 7 days, and then I blew it up. So
what?
We're back in the jet boat.
Are you fucking serious?
No.
I thought you were fucking around. What did you do?
No, yeah, so I got
thanks for asking, motherfucker.
Thanks, dude. No,
it's awesome. Before I blew it up.
Yeah, no, my buddy, a really good buddy of mine, had this boat for since 2008. He used it just a couple times a year. It sat, you know, it only had less than 200 hours on it. Thing is immaculately beautiful, brand new graphs, brand new trolling motor, brand new tires. Like, I couldn't say no to the offer he was asking, and so I took it, darn well knowing the risk of getting a motor that sat for a long time. Anybody that knows an outboard motor knows what you don't do is sit those things for longer than 3 months.
Yeah.
Mercury even says 30 days, you know, don't let that thing sits for 30 days. You've hurt your motor. I got like 7 trips out of it, and I'm just cruising, idling into the marina, and clonk, tonk, 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 and that's all she wrote. So she's at the shop now getting surgery, and she's in a coma. I like to say she's in a coma and she's going to come out soon. Back. So when she comes out soon, you know, I've got a whole new outlook on this bass game here, because I've got grass and I've got the point one, but
what size engine did it?
I've got a new boat. It's a 20 footer with a 250 Pro XS on it.
Yeah.
I've got the live scope on it. I've got all the toys.
Live scope. You get to do video game fishing.
I get to do video game fishing with my swim bait now, which that's going to step this game a different direction. And I don't know if the shore guys know this or not, you know, or a lot of the swim bait guys know this yet, but, what I learned in having that thing on my boat for 7 trips, good night. Good for
I'm sure.
When Paul says good night, it's a scary, scary thing.
He never says good night to me before.
He tells me good morning, but not good night.
it's going to change the swim bait game for the guys that know
how to use it.
That want to learn how to use it.
Well, it's just fucking point it in front of you. They're swimming. I mean, there's a little bit of art to it, but for the most part, I mean,
I call it bed fishing throughout the whole lake.
It's kind of
what it is now. If you know electronics, you know, you can go over a spot with your electronics and have the down scan, side scan, and you'll never see a fish on the spot. And there's 50 fish down there.
Yeah.
When they sucked close to the bottom, you're not going to see them.
That's more for suspended.
If you don't have a live scope, or if you have a live scope or any of these other ones, you know, if they're on the bottom, you're still not going to see them.
Yeah.
So I see all these guys.
Active target. Shout out Lorenz.
Yeah. Shout out Lorenz.
Are you guys holding Lorenz?
Yeah. Yeah. today we see these guys just fishing a spot, and then before you know it, they're looking at their graph, pitching their drop shot around at this live scope targets, and before you know it, they're out in the middle of the lake and they don't even know it.
Yeah, they look up, they're like, oh,
Harley.
They're just like following these fish around that they're saying they could be carp, they could be catfish. There's everything that swims in this
That's
lake.
That's wild.
And so, addicting as a cell phone, dude.
Yeah, so what I'm noticing is
crack.
Everybody staring at their screens and not fishing. And so I'm going to find the balance of when that's usable and when it's not usable. Yeah. Like right now, me and Johnny have been filming for the past few days here. Haven't had the light scope out once. Yeah. We've just been blind casting.
But I think it'd be good when you're researching and you're going, okay, you could see how that fish sets up on rock or some shit.
Or
like
where
that.
It comes from. Yeah. Because the cool thing about that is it's going to tell you where it comes from. And you're going to see a follower behind your swim bait. You're not going to have any clue where that fish originated from. So that you know where to throw back to. You may have a general area, but you're not going to know exactly where to throw it as you would with a live target where you're like, oh crap, the boulder to the right of that one is where that fish came off of. You know, you're just going to see a fish behind it saying it came from here. You know, now we're getting real dead serious on it. And I think it's going to change that swim bait game. I really do.
What other lakes you guys fish a lot?
We got Berryessa right down the road, maybe 45 miles away.
Which I think is arguably one of the best lakes in the country. Really? I mean, that place has, I think a record large one is 17. They got 15 plus largemouth. Wow. They got 10 plus pound spotted bass. There's a 9 pound smallmouth cojada out there. I mean, there's no lake in the world that has that.
Yeah,
no,
all three like that. Yeah. None.
Yeah, I like to tell people, they say, well, you know, what do you think the best lake in the country is? And I'm like, Berryessa, bar none. There's a world record largemouth, a world record spot, and a world record smallmouth all in the same lake.
Yeah.
And I promise you, all three are in there. I absolutely 100% promise.
And they're trout eaters. Too.
And they're all trout eaters.
Any lake that has trout, and you know, I'll tell you another lake I think has got a fucking a 24, 25 is Pedro or Maloney's.
Yes.
Those Maloney's two lakes, sure. Maloney's particularly, that, God, those lakes are
dude, when
healthy.
That lake, when that lake was low and you saw the trees, you're like, I see. Yeah,
that lake, that lake's got them for sure.
What about the Delta? You guys fish the Delta a lot?
Places of love, hate.
It's super love, hate, dude. Yeah.
Hard
know,
one, huh?
You throw, okay, bass fishing's hard enough as it is. You throw current into the mix and sea lions?
Dude,
no.
How crazy
sea lions?
Throw current and sea lions into the mix. Just throw those two into any of your local ponds and tell me how well you do at bass
fishing.
That's
like saltwater.
And then 4 foot fluctuation, throw that on top of that. Yeah, like, fuck.
Yeah, it's awesome, but it's not my cup of tea, man. I like going flipping and frogging and with the best of them, you know,
I
can do it, you know. But when it comes to the Delta, it's got giants, but
we fish a lot on them too. We fish a lot of Potomac River, Mississippi River, you know, St. Lawrence River. I fished them all. And they say, well, you know, it's current. Like, fucking, they'll set up, you know, exactly where they are. It's like, bullshit. You know what I mean? Like,
you know exactly where they are. Yeah, one person on the whole
and these,
area.
And these cats out here grew up fishing. Like, if their troll motor's not hitting fucking the bottom, like, they're not fishing. Like, I'm the opposite. My troll motor hits the fucking ground, I'm out. in Texas, like, if I'm idling and I come up over, you know, if my boat picks up over a stump, I'm fucking gone.
Dude, what I realized.
I'm gone. Like, it spooks me out. But if you're not in that shit, you just don't fucking catch them.
Do you feel like when you fish the Delta, like say if you're going to go fish another river system, we go pre-fish there a little just to get
I know that. Are you really all that's going to do is confuse the fuck out of you. You know what I mean? 100%. Yeah. And tide fishing is always changing. There's certain areas where fish will live throughout the year. You know, just based off certain things. But bait's not there. Then there's just so many variables. It's just particularly in a river system. You know,
and
what I mean?
The sea lion thing's a whole nother.
Oh gosh.
Well, who knows how much they've impacted? I'm sure the locals know it's bad.
Yeah, I've heard Caesar and the guys go, dude, we've caught big fish, and you just see him. They bite the belly right out of the
like the bedfish. Well,
you'll see him throwing them up and like playing around striper and bass.
Like,
and
this fish was so dumb, it was in 2 foot. I just ate it. It stayed in one spot.
Can you believe that, Fred? Let's go get another one. They're all over here. Fuck it, see them all. There's a whole mess of them. They're not moving. They're just sitting there. I don't know what the fuck's wrong with them.
I've been biting the belly. That's it. The rest tastes like
just
crap.
Take the good stuff. Let's just take the good stuff.
They say that the fucking tournament guys. The fucking sea lions will sit there.
Oh, at the bottom of the tube?
And they'll just fucking wait for them to drop.
Wouldn't you?
Free dinner, dude.
Yeah, fuck, I would too.
Guys, we have to make sure we release the fish nicely into the water.
Right.
That's why they go down the tube.
Yeah, if anyone doesn't know that, by the way, the Delta here in Cali, we don't dump fish in the water. We send them down a fucking 40-foot tube. It's like a fucking water slide for fish, and seals are waiting at the bottom with their goddamn mouths open, just eating them like fucking pelicans.
And that's literally what they do, too.
Isn't that
I'm not making that up.
That's kind of crazy.
Yeah. I just think it's wild that they can't be like, oh, this isn't working. Should we just, drive them somewhere?
We should be able to. Right. Never mind.
Hey, come on. You could throw shade at that.
No, I was going to say harm a seal, but I like animals. I'm not about harming
animals. They did it down south a lot.
Oh, yeah. They're crossbows or shooting with bow and arrows. People
dude, there was a captain I heard that
I could never do that.
Shooting.
Oh yeah,
22s and stuff.
I want to make that very clear. I do not. I do not. I'm not full. I know. I'm serious.
I do not condone shooting seals.
I'm a god for that. I do not believe in.
Hey. I love animals. Fuck people, but I love animals. You know what I mean? Animals over human beings all day. I don't harm animals.
Oregon, they can shoot them.
Well, you can do meth in Oregon too. Shit, you can do whatever the fuck you want in Oregon. You can,
oh, I know. Yeah. Oh, they legalize.
You can fuck your brother and sister at the same time. Do meth. You do whatever you want.
Shit. Oh man.
Did you hear about what Johnny got arrested for what? Sucking his brother's dick. Bullshit. It's legal now. You didn't hear?
Oh man, we went sideways. We went so sideways.
Anyway, so these fucking seals, they suck, man. It was terrible.
You guys are fucking wild. What time is it? I know you got to get out of here.
No, I'm good. I could probably do 6:15.
All right.
But
I'm having a good time.
Yeah, I don't want to hold you up, man.
No, you're fine.
Hey, man,
if I got a split and you guys still talk, it's fine. I think the 6:15 I got to get, but it's fine. I'm enjoying it.
No, for sure.
Just drinking this cold Pacifico.
Yeah, he is.
There you go with the
shout out Pacifico.
Shout out Pacifico. Shout out AFCO. Shout out the Rants. Shout out I-Rod. Owner Hook Seagar Fishing Line. Falcon Tires. What up, baby? Thanks for the tires.
What are 6 cents, right?
6 cents. I'm sorry, Casey. I love you too. Zach, thanks, guys. They got some new soft flats. Real talk, 6 cents. Speaking of which, I do want to say something. They got some new baits out, soft plastics. They've come out the past couple of years. They've really been changing the game. They got these new thing called Hog Wallet. It's like a brush hog mixed with a creature bait, and they're fucking money. They're dope colors. A lot of new cranks out, top water. Check them out, 6 cents.
There you go.
Boom.
Nice commercial, 6 cents.
There you go.
I want some money for that, Casey.
That'll be $500.
How did you hook up with Pacifico?
So my ex, fuck her. her dad.
Is there any more left? Yeah. I'd like another one.
There's one left. You can have it. Her dad owned a bunch of Round Table Pizzas, and actually, this is actually a really funny story. I had a guy, and Paul can probably claim this too. We get a lot of message requests, and generally look at all of them. A lot of times we ignore them, and I got a message from a guy saying, "Hey, I met your girlfriend's dad at Round Table, and talk about your fishman." This
I love Round Table. I'd love to talk about.
Shout out Round Table. Yeah, shout out Round Table. So good. Meat Lover Pizza, extra crispy white sauce. And he wrote me and said, "I met your girlfriend's dad." Blah blah blah. I know she sucks, Jake. I know. Fuck her. I'm with you, bro. For those of you who don't know, Jake just said she's a bitch, and he's not lying. He messaged me, blah, blah, and I thought I was just some guy, this and that. And I ended up talking to him. I was like, yeah, that's the head guy for distribution, blah, blah, Constellation Brands, blah, blah. And I said, well, maybe I'll hit him back. He said, we should get a beer sometime. I said, yeah. I said, do you guys sponsor this and that? And he goes, well, yeah, we sponsored, Anaheim Angels, Sacramento Kings, this and that. And he said, I think maybe we can, meet up, this and that. So long story short, I met up this guy in his backyard, had a cup of Corona, told him my story. Something that I want to give people a tip on how to get sponsors. And it's not, this might not be perfected, but what I do is I'm just fucking me. I think people appreciate someone when someone's pretending, for me anyway, I can tell. You're full of shit. Someone appreciates authenticity. I got an authentic tattoo down my throat because I want people to see that. It's who I am, blah, blah. So anyway, it helped. But I met the guy, and months went by, nothing. He got me in contact with another guy. I asked for a certain amount of money, a lot, because that's what you do. You start high and you get low. I won't get into what I'm getting, but, I got just, it just kind of happened. It just materialized. I got in touch with the head guy, and, we had a Zoom call, he wanted to know who he was dealing with, this and that. And I was myself, and this and that. Loved it. Met up the guy and worked out a deal. I get free beer all year. I get to represent it. And not only that, I get to represent a beer company that I thoroughly enjoy, I'm hoping that this is going to be the start of greatness. We talked about maybe doing a 3-year deal next year and really just trying to, push it, and which would be amazing, because every year for me, it's like, fuck, you got to come with this amount of money. And
well, it's cool too, because I feel like you know how to market yourself. So, only that, I mean, nothing knocking your how good of an angler you are, but you're not like the very top Kevin Van Dam, but you know how to make it work. And you're like almost giving people advice to like dudes that are coming up and going, fuck, how am I going to pay for it? Well, you got
to
market yourself.
You have to market yourself. So. And what it comes down to is, being successful helps. And I've been fairly successful at the tour level, But it's what it comes down to is how can you, how can they benefit from you? When you're just searching for people just to do it, when you believe in something, you promote it much better. I have the best. I have the best sponsors in the fucking world. Like I really truly the Owner Hook, Seagar, Six Cents. Owner Hooks I've been using them as a kid. Lowrance units. These people believe in me. I believe in them, and that's what makes a team work. When you're doing something when you're just trying to get a fucking handout, I don't believe in that. I'm not. I actively search companies that I want to be a part of.
Right.
I want to feel like with YouTube fishing that it's been a little more difficult with getting sponsors because like
someone will do it for free. Why are you going to pay someone?
Even what I'm doing, if someone say they do a podcast and they just get free stuff. Well, that's cool, but it doesn't pay for like new board, new mics. You know what I'm saying? Where I've invested so much. So it's kind of like, do you think that the same things happen with the fishing industry where you're kind of giving away
At the lower level, yeah. But at the high level, no. Because at the high level, the people that are willing doesn't do them any good. The lower level is like, yeah, but anyone can promote it. But at the end of the day, it's not really doing anything. They have no audience.
They have no reach.
Exactly.
But see, some of the times I see you'll see a YouTube fishing channel have a bigger reach than like a top echelon elite dude.
Yeah, but reach to whom? Who's it reaching?
But I agree.
What it is.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They would know. Johnny would know more about that.
For professionals, when they're promoting baits, it carries a lot more clout, right? There's a lot more respect. So if he says he likes a certain 6 cent square bill, it carries that, you know, and everybody's like, okay, like I believe him. Like he fishes professionally. And YouTube is just kind of different, you know? You kind of build a different kind of audience, and it just depends on how that page is built. I mean, it works. Both of them work. And right now in the fishing industry, there's when endemic sponsors, which are companies that are within the fishing industry, like Pacifico is non-endemic, which is really hard to get and awesome.
Those are the best kind to get.
Yeah.
Non-fishing related.
Non-fishing related. Yeah. But there's this big split that's kind of happening where money's being allocated to professionals, which has always been like the top. But now the YouTube creators are coming in because they sell a lot of baits too. So it's just kind of two different markets.
It has been harder to get, I guess, if you were searching for cash sponsors. The way I see it, and it's a total business standpoint. Let me fix this a little bit.
Sorry, I gave him the quitter.
No, you're good. Yeah, of course I get the quitter. But it's just different. A YouTube kid, we'll call it, that has 100,000 followers right now, he's going to reach 500,000 people, you know, easily.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Easily with one video, maybe two videos. A tour pro, it's going to be harder to reach 500,000 people. Now, the only place that kid's going to be seen is on YouTube. He's going to reach a tour pro is going to reach 60,000 people. Just fake numbers. We're just guessing here.
Because at the same time, the YouTube, the tour pro,
it all depends on the platforms.
Yeah, yeah. Yes. Like, do they have a big Instagram following?
Where that video is going to be shared by another company that's more significant than the YouTube channel.
Did they do a good video? Right. Are they going on Bass Talk Live? Yeah, are they going, you know, like shit like that.
Right. So a tour pro's reach is harder to determine than a YouTuber.
Mm-hmm. That's the difference.
That's what it is. Yeah. So you don't know what a tour pro's worth because, yeah, his numbers on YouTube may not say the same as some kid that's got 6 million views. But his ability to sell a lure. Or a bait,
Who's going to buy a bait from? Some kid, some 17-year-old who's got $500,000 or guys no, but, for a fucking living.
But that's for like tournament anglers. Sure, like there's kids that just pond fish.
Sure, right. Sure.
Or go to the lake once in a while and they resonate with the YouTuber. Yeah, but you're saying, like you were saying, like after a tournament's won, you look at Tackle Warehouse and that bait that it was won on is sold out. I mean, but there's no way to really tell. You know how that traffic was driven there.
Tactical bassing.
Yeah, and they have.
They could push a fucking bait to sell like.
And guess what they got? They got affiliate links, so that every time somebody clicks on that link,
they're making percentage.
Tackle Warehouse gets notified. Fuck. So that's how the game's changing. Right. But there's like a certain level of respect with the tour guys that still carries a lot of stuff. No. You know. So it's just splitting up. It's just a little different.
Yeah. It's making it harder for sure to answer your question. Yeah. It's damn harder now to get paid fishing than it was before.
My understanding, too, Paul's been doing it a lot longer than I have, but I remember guys telling me back in the 2000s where, it was getting money from people was a fucking breeze. It was nothing. People were just throwing money around.
You could bullshit easier than, you know what I'm saying? Right.
That's what it comes down to.
Right. Yeah. You could have bullshit a little more. Well, like, you win a couple tournaments. And you don't have to do shit because you say, this is here. There you go.
Yeah.
Like nowadays, it's like, what are you doing? What else are you doing?
It certainly makes it easier.
You know, like
being successful, being a good market, being a good salesman helps. That's your ultimate goal. But I can promise you that winning fucking helps.
Winning builds your background.
Yeah, it helps.
For people to respect.
Of course,
You know, like I didn't get calls because, because I was a nice guy for guide trips. You know, I got calls because I won tournaments, and I got calls because I caught big fish.
Yeah.
And so you got to prove yourself, and the tour pros seem to prove themselves and they get trusted. So, but yeah, I mean,
it goes back
it's just
to
a different, I guess, you would know, like from BMX, it's like how stuff's changed just from like,
How about my previous fighting career about Paul's BMX?
Well, this is one thing.
Killer riding bikes, man.
I forgot about that. Yeah, we got to talk about Paul.
You're sitting in front of two trophies that are touching the fucking ceiling behind you. Because you can't see it, but he's got like 14-foot trophies.
Yeah, I used to ride then.
I did, man. I rode BMX from, 12 till I retired when I was 24. So 92 to 2004.
That's wild, dude. Yep.
And, man, I'd just travel the country, man. It was so freaking cool. I'd get a budget from a sponsor.
Were you racing, double A?
No, I never raced double A pro. I raced amateur until 2000 when I was 20.
Then you had to move, right?
And then I turned to A pro and I raced A pro, but I never made it past A pro because
I
didn't
expert
want to.
The whole time. And then you went to
expert from when I was 12 until I was 20.
Okay. And then you started doing downhill.
And then I started doing the downhill BMX when the X Games came about. I got really hurt in, I think, 2002, broke a couple bones in the leg, and that was it. You know, I ended up, my brother said, hey, you know, you can't move. You can sit in the back of the chair in my bass boat. You want to go try these big swim baits? And that's how that all started, man. I was hurt from BMX. And
that's wild.
Yep.
What a small world, though. Like, even some of the stuff, I mean, I owned a bike shop. You know some of the dudes. You knew Mike Escamilla, you know, you rode.
Yeah. I mean, Rooftop was on my team on Hoffman Bikes. Now, they were the freestyle division, and we were the BMX division, you know. But, like, Steve Swoop, Matt Hoffman, you know.
Steve Swoop
was our team manager. He was the one everything would go through.
OG, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, those guys really helped me a bunch. You know, I rode for Vans from the time I was 13 till the end of my career, 24. And Jake doesn't like Vans for some reason. But but Vans was freaking awesome. And I had a bunch of the best sponsors in the world. Dude, it was wild. Awesome. It was awesome.
Did you see the documentary yet? Hoffman's?
Yes.
I haven't watched it. It's pretty good.
It's amazing.
I can't wait to watch it. Is it on Netflix?
Netflix.
Okay, I got to watch that.
It's freaking awesome, man. He is a beast. He's a businessman. He's an icon. He's an innovator. And there'll never be anybody like him. The only person ever like Matt Hoffman is Evel Knievel. And I think that's enough said about Matt. He is the man.
Yeah, no, I agree 100%. Yeah. BMXers. Right.
BMXers, man. Not only that, but his business sense, man. You know, to see what he did with Hoffman Bikes and to see what he did with the X Games. And I don't know if people know, but Matt's a big part behind the X Games.
Yeah.
And he just grew every extreme sport there is to just 10 levels from what it was. And that's just what he did. So
yeah, I agree.
Props to Matt. Thanks for taking me in, buddy.
You have some tournaments you're going to fish this year as well?
I'm going to fish a couple of just local tournaments.
Just a local stuff?
Yeah, you know, we'll do the FLW if they come, and we'll do the
Have
one
you ever
Bass
tried to
Open.
Go full on?
I did the, I've never tried to fish the tour. I did a,
But you should. You'd smash.
I did a whole tour one season.
I wish you could come with me.
2010, I did the whole one Bass tour. I did the Southerns. I did, what was it, like Mojave, Havasu, Mead, those. And then I did the Northern Tier, Shasta.
It's not your shit.
It was cool. I won Angler of the Year. I won I won a boat. You know, I think I top 10 every darn tournament there was that year. And then the next year I was just like, man, that was cool, you know, but that's not my cup of tea. There's so much preparation that goes into traveling, and
you like being home
and being away from your house. Yeah,
he ain't lying when he says
he's a homebody.
Dude, I'm a big homebody, man. And it's hard to get me away from Clear Lake.
It's below 40. Paul ain't going fishing.
Oh yeah. Snowing. Yeah, snowing.
Nope.
Yeah, the cold.
No.
People, will you go when it's snowing? You won't touch the lake.
No, not usually. Not if it's snowing, because there's 364 other days out of the year that I could go out there.
But can you still catch a big one?
Oh, my God. Oh, absolutely. These fish love storms.
Yeah, you probably catch the biggest one when it is snowing.
I've caught my biggest bags on this lake when
What's
it's
your,
dumping
PB
rain.
Here?
My PB here is 12 and three quarters. I've never got a big one out of Clear Lake. Now,
I don't think there's a bunch
there's
of
not
15
a lot
teeners
of
in here. You know
there's
I mean?
Not a lot of teeners.
What's
in
the
Clear
record?
I think 17. Oh, wow. 17 and a quarter, I believe, is what it was. Southern California, before I moved up, I ended up catching a 16 and a quarter on a HUD. It was
where?
At Casitas.
At Casitas?
Yep, and that was on the cover of Western Outdoor News, actually.
There you go.
Yeah, dude, that was cool. That was the first time I ever made a cover. But yeah, no, that thing, that was on the HUD when it was still a prototype, you know, and everything was kind of just getting going, so.
Yeah. Did you have a lot to play in with the HUD?
No, not at all. I was just some BMX kid that was this guy, Sean Bailey's little brother. Nobody knew who I was. Sean and Matt were the man, were the guys winning everything back then. I was just kind of in the right place because I knew the right people. That's all that was.
No, I mean, that's a big deal, though. I mean, you put your mark on the swim bait scene a lot, but I also think it's really cool you kind of just stepped away because you didn't like how things are going.
I wanted to say something real quick, too, about the rods, too, about his rod and his iRods in general, is that people are always like, what's the best swim bait rod? What, you know, what? Listen, these guys have been throwing swim baits before anyone ever knew what the fuck they were. So if you think there's a better person to design a rod for a swim bait, you're out your goddamn mind. I mean, it's period. Like, if you want to throw a swim bait of any sort and you're not throwing an iRod, you missed the boat, period. And again, I'm not knocking any of the rod companies. I'm sure they're great companies, but these guys have been doing it forever. They were the first ones to do it. You think that they have the most experience, period. So you think they have all the, and they put that into a rod, it's going to be the best rod.
And I feel like your video kind of like came back around recently, maybe in the last couple of years, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Where I think everyone knows swim baits is like the fucking thing right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Everyone and their mom's throwing a swim bait. And it's like... it's like extreme sport thing. It'd be swim bait fishing.
Yeah.
You know that someone said that. I forgot who. Yeah. I think it was on an interview. Someone was like, you know, BMX and all this. I don't know what podcast it was. It's all together. Like, it's like usually the dudes that throw swim baits, did something like that before, like road bike, skating, music.
Got knocked out in 14 seconds.
It's too much for you. You're done with it.
Well, I knocked him out way worse. So watch the video.
Watch the video.
But you know what I'm saying? I feel like it's coming back around. And you know, you guys, you know, people started watching it again. It was on YouTube, right?
Yeah, we were able, you know, we sort of got permission to put it back on YouTube.
Which video is this?
The big game
positive. Oh, gotcha.
So, and the funny thing is so many new kids have gotten into the sport in the last 10 years. They didn't even know the Big Bait Posse existed. They really didn't until we kind of brought it back around. And then everybody kind of said, they did that in 2009.
If you have not watched it is some of the most intense. The punker footage is some shit. They're like, oh,
dude,
my
that, God. That made it all time.
People come on boat all the flipping tens and talk about that video.
Yeah. You know, it was just one of those, you know, I had the BMX vision of you know, having BMX videos made and being in BMX videos and whatnot. And then seeing that vision with swim baits, because it was so much cooler than any other fishing, you know, and that's
I think you edited it. So it was a BMX influence.
It was motocross, BMX, skateboarding, you
that's
know,
what
but
I love, and I like to know. Yeah.
BMX. Yeah. That it was all motocross BMX. Shit, dude, that's what it was. You know, my sponsor was a Moto Triple X. Yeah. They had a factory racing team, a freestyle team, you know,
you had to learn how to do all the editing though yourself.
No. So I got lucky here. So check this out. So,
but wait, there's more. There's more.
So my,
that's not it.
My team manager, a guy by the name of Kurt Holler, shout out to Kurt, man, helped me in life like nobody's ever helped me. Took me under his wing when he started Moto Triple X. I signed a contract with him. He was my BMX sponsor for my last 3 or 4 years. And I had the vision for the Big Bait Posse, and I kind of took it with him. This is probably 5 years after I retired from motocross and BMX and all that good stuff. And I called Kurt. We had golfed once a week ever since then. And said, Kurt, dude, I got, you know, this is what I want to do with fishing. Let me show you some of what we've got so far. You know, what do you think you can do? He's like, come to the office. Let's check it out. I went in there, and he just looks at me, and he goes, let's do it. And it was that easy. And I said, what do you need me to do? He says, you give me all the footage. I'll get music rights. I'll edit it together. I'll get distribution. I'll get titling. I'll get sound. I'll get effects. And I just looked at him and said, deal.
This was on VHS still, right?
This is on DVD.
DVD.
So, yes, okay. This was when the whole DVD VHS market was crashing. No, it was when everything was crashing and everything was going to just online you know.
Blu-ray.
DVD. Yeah, everything was going to Blu-ray. And we got hosed.
Just fucking a year.
Yeah. Exactly. And it changed so fast, and we dropped it right in that time. And so, you know, it goes back to doing stuff for free. We made the Big Bait Posse. It took us 2.5 years. We spent camera time, paid, like I said, paid editors, paid titlers, paid sound guys, paid music guys. We didn't make a dollar. None of us made one single dollar.
Do you know how many
dollar.
Copies it sold?
It's hard to say. We had an original 7,500 printed, and we were out of them within 4 weeks.
Oh, my God. That's fucking awesome.
And not one person reordered.
No?
So we were done. We closed up shop. I said, Kurt, I don't know what to say other than I'm sorry. You know, I thought this was going to work, and DVD market was crashing at the time, and it's just kind of the way it went. And it was a big I'm sorry to Kurt. He put in a lot of time, and so did we, going to the lakes all the different days and filming for 15 hours.
But you made something that won't ever happen again.
We created,
you know, you created a piece of legendary.
Yeah. Right. We created,
when you say
a
legend,
brand.
I know it gets thrown around a lot. That was legendary. That
right.
Video.
And that's why I think it got so much traction again recently. It's just because you could see how swim baiting used to be. Like, you think it's cool now. Like, imagine when they didn't even know what swim bait was.
Right.
And they were eating it like that.
Even listening to Matt tell all the stories of fucking, you know, going, and he said he had his mom or something come film.
He would have his mom come film, and I mean, it was crazy stories. I mean, me and Justin Kerr were filming one day for his part, and I remember we filmed for 12 hours. I used every battery I had for that camera.
Hey, how cool is that part? Your part, you know, a bike video. It's like you're fucking 2 minutes, and you're like,
That was my goal behind it, you know. But I remember just the craziest things happen when you're filming for those things, and it sucks. But end of the day, 12 hours into it, battery dies. We pull into the marina. Justin goes, I'm going to cast over the point. And I said, do it. And he hooks a 14.5 pounder, and I was out of batteries. And I filmed with that kid for
what video?
Months.
What camera were you using then?
I don't even know. It was
Premiere.
I don't even know. It was an HD camera. It was right when HD first happened.
Okay.
And then
it was
we
like the Butch camera, kind of the same deal.
Yes, but then we realized that we had to get away from the HD and go back to digital because all of our footage that we had prior to meeting with Kurt wasn't in HD. So he said we can't mix the two.
Yeah.
Go back to digital, film the rest of it in digital. And so that was another reason why we didn't do very well with the Posse, financial wise, is because we went from digital to HD in that same year. And so everybody was like, it's not HD.
Oh,
yeah.
Fuck, dude.
Yeah.
This is high quality.
Yeah. Nobody cared. Nobody cared enough, but it was if when that one market crashes and you have another market in the same industry going to a different product, it just made it all really hard. But I think it's coming back now because it is just like a BMX video or a skate video.
Oh, yeah.
It's timeless, is what it is. Yep. You can watch that thing for 25 years from now and probably get just as pumped as you did the day you watched it the first time.
No, and I think it's cool to see it come back around. Especially, I mean, how big, like, Bass Brigade and Swimming Underground, all these big,
absolutely
huge staples now, you know, and even huge. New bait billers and people that have only been doing for 10 years now, you know?
Right, right.
And it's really cool to see. Like, I had Oliver on. It was cool seeing his video and, you know.
Absolutely. I mean, yeah. It's brought a whole – we started another industry within bass fishing is what I like to say. There is another industry within bass fishing.
I think that video kickstarted that industry. Like, is it's something different.
It's something like – it's almost like a cult movement.
Yeah,
it's really what it was.
Like punk rock.
That's what it was.
That's what it is, pretty much. It was just punk rock.
And that was my vision, dude. Let's start something. Now, I don't necessarily like the direction it went, but we gave it the nudge, and that was all of our intention was.
Just pushed it, let it roll down the hill.
That's it. We just pushed it and let it keep rolling. Man.
Well, dude, think about this stuff now, like with these bait drops, with these swim baits. It's crazy that many people make so much, like people make a living off of making a good swim bait.
Yep,
absolutely.
You know, it's awesome.
That's it.
That's amazing, right? I mean,
people always want to buy them.
Yeah,
it's crazy.
Keep losing them. I'll buy another one.
That's it.
Dude, I've lost some big baits.
Oh, me too.
I'm sure you have. I was like, nothing like a mother or anything.
The worst is when you fucking cast one off. That's way worse because you watch it fly in there. You're like, no.
Turn the trolling motor on. You know you're not going to get it.
You just stare. You just stare where it lands. Yeah. Just hit it 100. Don't take your eyes off it. Like, you get over there to rod and start burying it. You're like, I'm not leaving it.
Hey, break a fucking guide off. You don't give a shit. Just get it.
Yep. Yep.
Well, hey, listen, guys. I don't mean to cut short. I got to take off.
Yeah,
here.
we could close up. Yeah, or sponsors and
okay,
stuff.
Okay, cool.
And,
or if you guys want to keep going when I leave, it's
we can close up. It's fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. I'll let you leave. Go ahead.
You guys, let's talk about sponsors. Anything you want to point anyone towards?
Yeah, you know, I've been fishing the Gangcraft stuff a lot. Everybody knows I'm a big Gangcraft guy. To me, they had the first glide bait. Before anybody knew what a glide bait was, I'm going to give Tommy Cardoza props on this. Tommy, if you're listening.
Shout out, Tommy.
This is all you, buddy.
I drew him as a co-angler one time, and he showed me some shit.
Yeah, Tommy figurated one with him in a boat in a tournament.
And I was like, real quick story. So he had about 20 of them fall. The day before the tournament, goes, dude, I'm having a fucking follower every cast. I'm like, yeah, right. He was not fucking lying, dude. He had one come to the boat, and he starts figuring. I'm like, dude, this musky thing. And he literally figured, dude, fish ate it, set it, swung him in the boat in 2 seconds. I was just sitting there like, what the fuck?
Yeah, but so he opened my eyes to the glide bait, and they had one of the very first glide baits. I don't know if people know that, but it was out a long time before 2009. Just nobody wanted to look at it. They're like, that's the stupidest thing in the world.
Yeah, yeah.
Tommy turned my eyes onto it. I've been a big fan of their products ever since. So let's give a shout out to Gangcraft, iRod, obviously, you know, AFTCO. Huge shout out to Seth, Matt. You guys are awesome. I got a bunch of sponsors. I got Robo Worm. Yeah, nobody knows I'm a worm guy. You know, I grew up in Southern California. Nobody knows that I grew
Paul
up in Southern California.
Paul has a spinner rod in his pocket. If you know what I mean.
But you know, Robo Worm's done a lot for me. You know, that world record spot that I caught, you know, or supposedly not world record, however you want to call it. But I've got the best sponsors in the world. Everybody knows who they are because they see them on my stuff all the time. And thank you guys.
Yeah. Oh, get it out. Get it out. Get the phone out. Line them up.
It's what it is for me is, like Paul touched on, I mean, without these people, it's absolutely impossible for us to do what we do. And I've been fortunate enough to, like I said, gain and maintain a lot of sponsors. But I mean, Pacifico this year is done huge for me. You guys already know how good the beer is. Drink it. Drink responsibly. Mm-hmm. Don't drink and drive, obviously. If you're under 21, also, please do not drink unless you're supervised and don't have any keys in your fucking pocket. Sixth Sense has been huge for me. I've been on board with Sixth Sense for several years now. They're my title sponsor the past couple of years. Casey and Zach over there, they have absolutely murked it for me. They've provided me the best fishing tackle support, and they've really helped out. I've had a lot of fun with them. Electric sunglasses. I've been Electric a couple of years now. I think people, you know, it's funny. I grew up wearing Electric as a kid, and just loved them. And you know, years later, I'm sponsored by them, so it's a pretty cool deal there. Falcon tires. I've been running Falcon tires on the truck and boat for 2 years now. And man, I'm fucking telling you, dude, they quiet, affordable, the best bang for your buck. There's no doubt about it. Lowrance units. I've been using Lowrance since I was a child. It's hard to argue that anything's better than that, especially with Active Target coming out. I'll be having that in the boat hopefully this year. Actually, I will have them this year. It's just on kind of my back order. AFCO, just signed with them this year. They are, man, listen, guys, if you have not worn these clothing that AFCO provides you, I'm telling you right now, I would pay for these things, and I mean that. And I mean, I really sincerely mean that. The new Reaper sweater, fuck, it is unbelievable. Yeah. They have three different sets of rain gear. They got things from board source to underwear to hats to beanies to gloves.
And they got the best built-in mask.
It's unbelievable.
Oh, you can just put the mask
it's
on.
It's so comfortable. Yeah. iRod, obviously, I've been on with them for 8 years now, and Matt's incredible. Thanks, Matt, for what you do. I know I got two Signature Series rods coming out, or one out, another one coming out. It's fantastic. Modern Outdoor Media, they've been in charge of all my, you know, my web page and running my guide stuff. Seaguar Fishing Line, God, man, the best ever. They got this new gold label coming out, or it's actually out. Leader material, it's the thinnest, most strongest leader line you can possibly ever imagine. Don't sleep on that.
Jesus,
make sure
are
you get
a fucking
that.
Tour pro or something?
Mercury, running Mercury outboard. Owner Hooks, the best hooks in the business. And last but not least, Amped Batteries. I just signed on with them this year, and they've been lithium batteries. I've been able to run them the past couple trips out. Amazing, lightweight.
I'm scared of those things.
And you'll be just
they're awesome.
Being on tour and being afraid to run out of battery, it'll put your tail between your legs. But I don't have to worry about that anymore. I'm super stoked. FLW or MLF, happy to be out there to fish. My parents love you both. I'm stoked to get this year underway and hope to go win one.
Thanks for coming on, dude.
Thank you. I appreciate you having me.
John. Yeah, iRod, obviously that's why we're all here, the family and just the best rods on the market. And AFCO, we were just talking about how we don't have to buy any clothes anymore because AFCO has everything
ever
you need. Yeah, especially if you like being on the water a lot, and they got the best clothing in the market. So thanks for having us on.
Hopefully we see some more stuff from video coming.
Oh, yeah.
And thank you hopefully very much for coming out and doing this.
Yeah, no, this
really
is great. This is
thank you very much.
Probably
very
one of the funnest podcasts I've done in a long time.
Well, you knew
that was our plan.
You get us three together. It's a fucking wrap.
This was a great idea, guys. I'll tell you that right now. But thanks for being part of the NorCal series. I think it's everything next month is going to be all NorCal.
Cool.
Based, so it'll
we'll be
cool.
Listening.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
Thank you, man. Appreciate you.